Ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen!
I bring you Minority Report, Everybody Runs.
But I'm not able to-
Everybody Runs. You ask, what is a Minority Report? Is that when you blame it on the guy who can't speak English? Find out in this review, does Minority Report do the job other games won't, or should it be deported? Oh wow, that was a terrible play on words. Why did I buy this book? Game Trailers is my favorite gaming site, by the way. This game mimics the movie it's based on. Cops can predict and stop future assassinations before they happen, but one officer must prove they were framed for a murder they had no intention of doing. The film stars our greatest American actor, Tom Cruise, and he's cruising for a bruisin'. Allow me to present a clip of his theatrical performance.
Penis! Oh! Penis! Big fucking erect penis, Mom!
Okay, that was the wrong Tom Cruise movie. Tom is absent from both this game and his sanity. In his place, you are a very bitter, angry Anderson Cooper doubleganger.
You can't run, John!
You can't catch me.
Oh, snap.
Oh, Ander, what did CNN do to you? Why do you sound like Lex Luthor from the 90s Superman cartoon? The gameplay is what you'd expect from a movie tie-in. A simple beat-em-up with the same four enemy types. Environments are pretty nice. And ragdoll physics. Your motivation is to prove Anderson Cooper is not a moiterer by killing every single cop in your way. Make them like a salad and toss their asses. Fuck the police. Fuck interior design. Every single one of these cops were just 2 days from retirement. If they're dead, just keep hitting them. That's good. You don't want to risk a zombie outbreak, folks. Anderson Cooper, watch the movie Looper, does not feature Bradley Cooper. Oh my god, this game even has puke grenades. The final boss is Jesus Christ Laura Croft repeatedly punching you in the nads. Oh, my men's rights! It's an okay game, but the party doesn't start until you activate cheat codes. Look at it. Look at this game. I call this the give up on life button. Objective 1, find a way out of the building. I win. Yeah! Hello, I'm with CNN. As crappy as the upcoming Xbox One is going to be, if ragdoll button was a standard for every game, day one purchase right there. This game could not get any better.
Welcome to the training grounds. This is where pre-crime officers come to work on their basic skills.
Oh my god. Big time voice actor Tara Strong is the tutorial voice. The lady who voiced every cartoon ever and threatened to beat me up last year. The story of why she wanted to hurt me is in the description for the uninitiated. Some days I really wish Tara Strong did beat me up. I don't know if it's because I suffer depression or I'm a masochist.
Don't worry about hurting him. He can take it.
Oh, Tara.
Now, try a strong grab combo.
Oh, yes, Tara Strong. Please perform a strong grab combo on me.
My pleasure.
Oh, no, not you. And how does this wonderful game end? Presidential failure, Mitt Romney does a little dance, and the development team are presented as death row inmates. Bless this game. Now, my time here is over, as I ascend to the pearly gates. See y'all in Comic-Con, assholes!
I tried to go and tell the police, but even the authorities are minorities at my water park.
Guess who? The sponsor of tonight's video, Manscaped, also worked on female sexes too. We got the perfect package 3.0, kid. What's in here? The lawnmower 3.0. You know what this does. I don't need to tell you. It's super safe too. No nicks, no snags guaranteed. Trust me. USB charger, yeah. Get 20% off plus free international shipping with the code TAXI at manscaped.com. Also, the perfect package essentials, kids, includes all this: water resistance, high performance body trimmers, and liquid products. Keep yourself fresh with this home slice. With the peak hygiene plan, you get quarterly replenishments on products and replacement blades delivered to your door. Again, 20% off plus free international shipping with the code TAXI at manscaped.com. Your balls will thank you, and so will I. And also this box, apparently. Manscaped.
When there's trouble, you know who to call.
Ghostbusters!
I've been doing these videos long enough to wonder why I haven't killed myself yet. So now I feel it's time to look back on my old Teen Titan reviews I got saved on my Tumblr to see how it all began.
Hello, people.
Wow, that was awful, but it's been too long since I've shown just why I love this series so much. Do you remember your first viewing? Titans was so different from any other superhero cartoon going on then.
We need gravy, and plenty of it!
There was no secret identities, and it was nothing like the comics. To us kids, this was a team of heroes we never heard of, besides Robin, who is somehow the leader when he has no powers. You know why? Because the white man rules the world. I mean, the Red Power Ranger had things set, until the White Ranger comes in to take his role as leader and his girl Kimberly. Manifest Destiny. This was an odd mix of a Western anime. I was at first confused by the humor, yet I loved it so much.
Well, you're an oversized clutch and your feet smell like motor oil.
You're bossy, you're rude, you got no taste in music.
The feeling was aided by Japanese pop stars Puffy Yamayumi providing music and getting a cartoon soon after. It makes me wonder, where are they now? Yes, the show was insane, but it knew when not to joke around and made for some effective drama with each of the teammates' ongoing conflicts. Whether it be Robin's sociopathic obsession, Beast Boy's call to leadership, Raven's abusive upbringing, Starfire being a woman. But I would say Cyborg was the most fascinating, who faced discrimination for being,
You know.
You know what it feels like to be judged simply because of how you look?
Of course I do. I'm part robot.
His machinery makes him an outcast. Limits are built in. It restricts him from getting any stronger or having a penis. But he figures out his limitations shouldn't define him, and works around what he once considered a disability.
But you aren't all robot. Half of you is human, and that's the half that can beat him.
It all added up to a real Gurren Lagann moment.
Where in this vile contraption is the part that allows you to resist?
It's not in the circuitry, is it? It's not the machine that resists you. It's me, my spirit. That's the part you can't break.
Raven was also my favorite for her cynical attitude. Also, she never wore pants. She can even slice a rock creature in half with two fingers. I wonder what else she can do with two fingers.
You all should be ashamed for watching this.
That was Raven's voice actor, Tara Strong. An appropriate name because I'd like to Tara that ass up. Would you at all be surprised to find Tara Strong threatened to beat me up once? You can read about that venture in the description. She's cool about it, but excluding sexual harassment, the Titan's real archenemy was the masked hitman Slade. Providing the voice was the human cauliflower himself, Will Ferrell.
That's actually Ron Perlman!
Ron Perlman. You know, Hellboy and the announcer of A Thousand Ways to Die. You can't find a more sinister voice.
If you are truly evil, then go ahead. Do what you must.
Starfire, no!
Robin!
I gave you an order. If you won't attack, my probes will.
My friends and I would always debate who Slade was under that mask. Like, who do you think it is? Is it Two-Face? Is it Batman? I bet it's Batman. Why would Batman steal from Wayne Tech? I don't know, it's Batman. Oh my god, it is Batman. Fucking Batman! Fucking Robin! It's fucking Batman! Shit, it's Batman! Fucking Batman! We were honest to god the stupidest fuckers ever to not just look it up online. Slade was some dude named Deathstroke the Terminator. When I see Raven, I like to dick stroke my Sperminator. You'll find some crazy stuff online. My 11-year-old self was so confused when a Google search revealed that this was based off a comic? What? Y'all remember the Teen Titans Battle Blitz Flash game? Each week they unlocked a new hero to play as, until eventually you got to play as the villains. Not the deepest fighter, but it helped introduce us to the show. And what a show it was. Before cancellation, it was popular enough to receive an extra season and a straight-to-video movie where they journeyed to Japan, as if this wasn't already the biggest weeaboo shit ever.
Otaku?
Otaku? I think that means I'm cute.
Japanese culture, what's that? Let's go over there and kick Godzilla's ass! It settled Starfire and Robin's relationship, but by the end of it all, they introduced so many unanswered questions and new heroes, I wish it spun off into something like Justice League Unlimited to see more from the honorary titans like the Stapler, Trust Fund Boy, and Doot Doot the Trumpet Man. We never saw much of the titans after that, until last year, a new series of animated shorts were produced with a new full Teen Titans series on the way. But it's just gonna be a comedy. Well, I know the two in charge of this reboot will do their best with the series.
We've never even seen the old show.
No, I saw a couple episodes. It's good. It was a good show.
Good show.
Wow. Fuck you guys with consent.
Where is Robin? I do not understand.
We searched everywhere.
How could you not find him?
Robin, is that the best you can do?
You almost got hurt. Next time it could be worse.
No matter how hard I try, limits are built in.
There are those on other planets who feel Tamaranians are inferior.
I am afraid.
Don't you guys get it? They won, we lost. It's over!
I'm afraid, but that doesn't mean I can't fight back.
This may not be the perfect team, but it's all we've got. If we work together, we can accomplish anything.
They are my family. This is my home. And you are not welcome here.
It's so obvious Teen Titans was inspired by animes, mostly from Studio Gainax like Fooly Cooly, just from the overall tone. You may not like that scene with Cyborg and his willpower I mentioned before, but it was really a homage to Gurren Lagann's inspirational theme of robots powered by fighting spirits.
But Gurren Lagann wasn't even created when Teen Titans was running. That was just one big cop-out.
The final episode was one big nod to Evangelion's finale, where the honorary titan named Terra had no memory of what has happened through the series. It left so many fans confused, but it was a bittersweet note to leave off of.
Things changed, Beast Boy. The girl you want me to be is just a memory.
Am I disappointed in this new reboot? Superheroes in general are popular enough. This won't be the last Titans reboot we'll see. Let's enjoy this interpretation for now. Maybe these guys will do a good job, or maybe they'll go fuck themselves. I don't know. I'm not a professional. I'm a pizza. But what I do know is, when there's trouble, you know who to call.
Hello? You have the wrong number! Hola! Hello? Por favor, you have the wrong number!
No matter how you do the math, it all adds up to you going down.
So, are you going to go quietly?
Or is this gonna get loud?
I spend 4 hours at the gym every day.
Yeah. Do we have a special punishment for people who are
fans? It's summertime, and you know what that means. Gonna head out to the beach, gonna do some beachy things. It's summertime, feels just right. Gonna gather all my friends, and we'll party through the night. It's summertime, nothing. It's loving in the summertime. Summertime, nothing.
Knock, knock. It's me, Pan Pizza. And I'm blackety back, y'all. Being here in San Diego Comic-Con 2013, it's good to see people my age are into regular show, just like this guy who asked the creators a question.
Because I always wear one of your shirts, no matter where I am, or what day it is. And I get funny looks from old people, but I make a lot of friends with, like, little kids.
Thanks for coming, everybody.
prior to the con, the Children's Museum was having the regular show, Regular Zone. What's inside? No one knows. In the line, museum employees dressed as Muscle Man and the minor character Jack Farley humored and quizzed people on their regular show knowledge to expose how large of a social reject I truly am.
Who was the most recent park employee to be hired?
Thomas.
Look at his face, I just blew his mind. Answer a trivia question correctly and receive Jack Farley's business card from the High Score episode. You gotta commend them for staying in character the whole time.
Oh, you wanna see me flex a little bit?
Go ahead.
I don't think those people were actors. I think that's just Ted Turner.
Paper costs money. Paper doesn't grow on trees.
But wait a minute. Yes, it does.
Within the regular zone is an arcade decorated with fictional arcade cabinets from the show. You play some actual retro games until a power outage occurs and are taken to another room to button mash arcade sticks till the floor literally shakes and defeat the Destroyer of Worlds in some short animation. You then receive some fuzzy dice and a double-sided poster. It's the same image on both sides, but one half is day and the other is night. That's so profound, I can't take it. There was even a free store. Input a Facebook or Twitter account and receive a random prize. The regular show experience was good, but from all the events outside the con, my favorite was the Hello Kitty experience. That's when they put you in a bag and put some cats in the bag, then they shake the bag. This truly is a 2112 time attack. A 2112 time attack indeed.
Instagram!
What time is it?
Time Squad!
Yeah!
Time Squad.
Good little girl, always picking a fight with me. You know that I'm bad, but you're spending the night with me. What?
Well, this year's San Diego Comic-Con, Cartoon Network's booth has beheaded and hollowed out the Ice King's head for his crimes against the Geneva Convention. Inside, you see his home brought to life. Fans could come in to take photos inside his prison. Hey kids, who wants to pretend to be a kidnapping victim?
Yeah!
Every day a new princess button is offered. Here's the buttons I got. They ran out fast this year. Whoa, Satine was here? I didn't get his autograph. They repeated last year's quest to earn the Ice King's medal by texting clues. Still got my Jake medal from last year. They promoted the free BMO app for iPad and iPhone. It doesn't got much content, but updates are on the way.
Ouch. Ouch. Knock it off.
For a real game, Adventure Time, let's explore the dungeon because, I don't know, for PS3, Wii U, 360, PC, and 3DS was on demo. It's modeled after Gauntlet and Diablo. I got dibs on reviewing that in the regular show game this fall. Pendleton Ward, the series creator, hinted it may answer some show questions.
I just had a colonoscopy, so this is really making me nervous.
And now for the real fun. Got in line at 6 a.m. and made it to the Adventure Time panel at 11. Remember, the line never ends. Cartoon Network, please give me some press credentials next year. Twas a good panel indeed. Jake the Dog's voice, John DiMaggio, always brings the fun.
There's some people here that are too young for this. I'm gonna make somebody pregnant up in here.
My favorite panels are always the ones with voice actors assembled for live readings with audience participation. If you ever wanted to hear the creator of Adventure Time talk about Animal Crossing, now's your chance.
Because I hate cookies so much. I dig little traps around Cookie's house so that Cookie can't enter or exit the house without falling into the traps.
Yet again, a fan suggested the idea for a crossover, this time with My Little Pony.
I was wondering if you could do like a My Little Adventure Time, which would be really funny. Like, if the Adventure Time characters got turned into...
Jake isn't Rainbow Dash. That's not happening.
I mean, no crossovers, man. I'm not gonna do it. None. Except on t-shirts that are bootleg.
If you look at their reaction when the crossover was proposed, you see how disgusted they were. I guess Jeremy Shotta wouldn't want to ruin his street cred. Wait, this is Comic-Con, right? There's Adventure Time in regular show comics everywhere. I got this issue from Natasha Allergies, who created the Fiona and Cake characters and the Bee and Puppy Cat online cartoon. She refuses to believe my name's actually Pan Pizza.
That's a great name.
Thanks.
Oh my gosh, you guys, she was the nicest lady ever. Everyone, let's pretend extra hard that this and many of my older videos do not exist. I would delete that video, but some still like it. It's an example to what I used to be like, and what I hate the most. If someone makes you feel bad for liking something harmless they don't like, I can assure you, those self-entitled people got nothing else going on to define people based on what kind of song, movie, show, or game you happen to enjoy.
Sure, Bubbles.
Just a PSA. Even if you don't have tickets to Comic-Con, there's so many events on the outside to participate in. So now, Teen Titans Go seems to have been a real success for Warner Brothers to lay out these inflatable titans. I don't like what Robin's doing. How dare he point and laugh at my precious ravioli? Before the panel even started, I overheard little kids in line bashing on this new show, and knowing how angry fans in general could get, that got me excited. We could bear witness to the very first Comic-Con crucifixion. Blood will spill, limbs will detach, actor Will Arnett. Risking their safety, Beastie Boys member Mixmaster Mike the Dick Van Dyke showed up to drop his scary young person music with all but one titan present.
You on this phone, can you say hello?
Hello, wonderful friends!
The first Teen Titans series means a lot to them. They're just happy to be recording together once again.
I mean, our first job that we got, we walked in the booth and I whispered to him, I was like, man, this is my first job. I was like, really? This is my first job too!
On that day, I learned Robin and Beast Boy's voice actors are the whitest people I've ever seen since Tom Kenny. Oh, stop. No, stop. Just, no. No, no, Teen Titans don't go. Teen Titans stay in place. Greg Sipes truly knows how to BS an answer when a viewer asked why his character Beast Boy is green.
Because the color of the heart chakra is green, and Beast Boy is pure love, and so are all animals, they are pure love.
Actually, Beast Boy was on the verge of death from green fever until his parents mutated his genes to save his life, but I guess your answer works too. I got kinda bummed out when Beast Boy wasn't anywhere in this entire panel. Oh no, that's his voice actor's body right there, but he's really somewhere out there in space.
I just love how real the show is now. It's very true to life, you know? We explore a lot of real things.
I don't get that so much.
You know what Greg Sipes' favorite Teen Titans villain is? Brother Bud. They treated us to an early episode screening where the Earthbender Terra returns for 2 episodes. The second episode was just unfinished storyboards, yet it was so funny it didn't need animation. She shares no feelings for Beast Boy, and it has no continuation on that infamous final episode. But it confirms Raven does have feelings for Beast Boy, and Starfire admits she loves Robin as, quote, the brother.
But you don't know what Starfire means by brother, you know? She can have that.
No. Anywho, I've been ignoring one of the burning questions. If I got revenge on Raven's voice actor Tara Strong after last year's spaghetti disaster, check the description if you don't know. Well, she didn't remember wanting to beat me up last year. I was gonna ask her to autograph the shameful Raven drawings in my portfolio, but there were children around and that got me thinking what I'm doing with my artistic skills. On that note, I actually got video this time of my encounter. Here you go.
You don't remember?
The day
Tara Strong
graced your village was the most important day of your life. But for me,
It was Tuesday.
How many others did she threaten to beat up last year?
I don't think Pops has any kids.
Or great.
But that doesn't mean that, you know, in a really weird episode, he could maybe give birth some out of his head.
I needed rest from 3 videos in a row, so let me pump out at least 2 more. I didn't even touch on the regular show panel yet. Lay your eyes on this piece of merch for all panel attendees. Pops his head on a silver platter. I have finally slayed the beast and this is my trophy. We know what news to expect. A Halloween and Thanksgiving special coming, the 3DS exclusive regular show trapped in 8-bit land was shown to be a belated throwback of Nintendo games like Super Contra, Mario Bros, and Gradius. I better get a review copy this time.
Did you see me deliver that kill blow? That fool never had a chance.
The crew at the panel answered why Thomas was around. He's just to give Mordecai and Rigby someone to be a higher ranking than. A second fan asked if there will be a female counterpart for him. Is there gonna be a girl version of Thomas?
Thomasina? Is that what the name should be?
Thomas is the girl version of Thomas.
Now, do you recall how there's 2 pairs of Mordecai, Rigby, and Muscle Mans living in the same universe after a time-traveling disaster in the Night Owl episode? Mordecai's voice, J.G. Quintel, who made the show, ties up that flaw.
And then the ones that we saw on the side, they just live in another town now somewhere. They probably changed their names and realized that it's the only way to exist.
I think the best regular show announcement was when J.G. Quintel dished on a collector's item that was never made.
I wanted to give out at Comic-Con season 1 and 2 of regular show on Laserdisc.
I really want that so bad, if only factories could still manufacture Laserdiscs. Since this video is so short, I thought I could talk about some of the upcoming shows in this and the next video. Late in the fall, Steven Universe cometh with a more simplistic art style change. Before, after. I know, it's terrible. They didn't even put a background. This whole show's just gonna take place in a white void of purgatory. I think this is where Tobuscus lives. No more than 30 seconds of new footage was shown. It visually resembles and has the art team from Symbionic Titan. Steven Universe takes place partially in the real world and other times in a mystical domain. It's gonna look and sound amazing. The voice actors were picked for their singing talents after all. That pilot you may have seen was only a test. It was their choice to change it, so the characters are more distinct from one another. Look, if you don't believe me that's gonna be good, let's put some pros and cons here. Pros. Rebecca Sugar. Done.
Kill them all!
Ah, jeez, nothing but cannon fodder again. I wish they'd send in some...
This is bad! They're ganging up on Kamina and Simone!
What does a 12-year-old like?
Boobies!
Yes, yes, of course, but there has to be more.
Giant robots!
Yes! What else?
Drills! Plato's The Cave Analogy!
That's it! That's what 12-year-olds like! This is Tengen Toppen Gurren Lagann! Tangy Tasty Kenny Loggins!
From here on, the name of this mecha is Gurren Lagann!
Gurren?
Lagann?
Oh, please.
An anime in which humanity lives underground as the resistance leader Kamina dreams of saving the surface world oppressed by mechs. In Kamina's battalion is an army and his 3 friends. A sniper, a little boy, and a homosexual. You'll never guess what happens when they walk into a bar. Go ahead and guess. You really can't. It's crazy, I know.
Who the hell do you think I am?
Who the hell do you think I am?
Who the hell do you think I am? Kick!
That's Kamina's catchphrase. He repeats it, yet no one ever answers. Just who the hell did they think he was? Whatever uttered by Kamina is a motivational speech. He knows his squadron, Team Dai Gurren, can achieve anything with their mechs fueled, not by electricity or gas, but by believing in themselves If in distress, they're powerless.
Come on, everybody! If you don't believe in him, he can't hurt you! Oh, God, the pain!
Now, Gurren Lagann isn't about Kamina. His friend Simon, as pathetic as you see him, is the focus. He relies on and feels inferior to Kamina.
He was tough and kind, and he was big. I wanted to be a man just like Bro. I really tried to be, but I guess it was no use.
Simon never accomplished anything. Never touched the boob of a woman. He's never even watched The Lion King. What the fuck? I thought everyone watched The Lion King. From childhood to old age, the audience witnesses Simon develop confidence and his independence from Kamina.
I'm not my bro. I'm me! Simon the Digger!
Not just that, but from the start, Simon in his depressed state still had purpose in his own and other people's lives. Gurren Lagann is so over the top that its cheesy message just makes it all the more impactful. I don't understand why every show can't feel this monumental.
Just who
in the hell do you think we are?
It's all about continuing to push forward like the drills they carry and being open to the unknown. Otherwise, you sit there closed off, drawing the same art styles and recycling the same ideas over and over. If you're jonesing for more, search up the series of music videos entitled Parallel Works and the two movies. It's the exact same TV footage shortened with about 20 minutes of redrawn animation.
Alright, you two, you better get back!
My favorite anime? Yes, but it's not perfect. Introducing Yoko Littner the Sniper. Yoko, oh yeah.
That girl's actually 14 years old.
Yoko, oh no. Sexual relations with a 14-year-old girl. That's the way Team Die Gurren rolls. Hey, baby. My name's Kamina, and I'm about to come in ya.
No!
I got really fed up with all her fan service. Yeah, I know the whole series is exaggerated, but the titillation got out of place at times of despair where it just wasn't necessary. I think it would benefit the show if they just tone it down a bit.
Never!
Okay, okay. She at least had ambitions and fight in her, while Princess Nia is nothing more than a trophy to be rescued. Her qualities include being helpless and spending a lot of time in the kitchen? Well, she does offer advice and has a bigger part in the movies. I also got a gripe on the evil Spiral King. Not gonna spoil what he knows, but hey man, you could have like said something.
Go away.
Now, you think Inception was overly complicated? You have not watched the final arc of Gurren Lagann. They're sinking in space water because they're sad, so their spiral energy that binds the universe is going in reverse, and they're in a sub-dimension with anti-spiral energy. The mole turns human, I don't know, and then Flambo comes along and gives them a flame shield, but it can only be used on a Wednesday on a full moon, and then they're hit with probability-altering missiles.
Probability alteration?
Whoa, I'm impressed.
Yeah, that's a thing in the show. Probability altering missiles. Hey, where do you want to eat? Oh no, you've been struck by indecisive choice lasers. I think the message of the show justifies how unnecessarily complicated it is.
It's hopeless. We can't beat him.
Don't give up. Kicking logic out and doing the impossible is the way Team Gurren rolls.
Yeah, fuck logic. I'm tired of being told what I can't do. I say I can't breathe underwater. Take these lemons and ask for a refund.
Yeah, take the lemons.
I can do it. I can breathe underwater. I'm gonna be king of the pirates.
It's no use. I can't do anything. There's just
anything I can do now.
Let's see you grit those teeth!
Why, bro?
I give you my word that if you ever start to doubt yourself, I'll come and belt you one. Kick logic out and do the impossible. That's the way we roll.
Your old man did nothing but spout crap like that.
Now that you have lost your body, you don't have the slightest hope of winning.
Quit your stupid yammering! I'm not gonna lose! The me that my bro believed in, the me that I believe in, isn't ever gonna lose to the likes of you! Push your way down a path you choose to take and do it all yourself. That's the way Team Daikuren rolls!
For his sake alone, we'll keep on moving forward!
If there's a wall in our way, then we smash it down! If there isn't a path, then we carve one ourselves!
Not in the Simon that I believe in. Not in the Kamina that you believe in. Have faith in the Simon that believes in you.
Impossible, see the invisible. Row, row, fight the power.
Plato's allegory of the cave. A fable of these fruit roll-ups bounded underground. They've experienced absolutely nothing except for this god-awful puppet show they've been forced to watch since birth. Oh my god, it's terrible. 20,000 BJ before Jeff Dunham. One prisoner is brought to the surface and returns to his inmates because he forgot his iPod and wants to brag how cool it is outside, only to be ridiculed for his lack of nipples. They laugh because they refuse to believe there is an outside world.
This mysterious surface of yours doesn't exist!
Like hell it doesn't!
People demand consistency. They accept and spread what they've been taught and scoff at those who oppose what's thought to be impossible.
1,500 years ago, everybody knew the Earth was the center of the universe. 500 years ago, everybody knew the Earth was flat. And 15 minutes ago, you knew that people were alone on this planet.
Imagine what you'll know tomorrow.
This is where Gurren Lagann got me thinking. Is anything really impossible? Or do people quit before they make it a reality? You may tell yourself you're not good at drawing or singing or sports, but why? I theorize it's because you've been spoon-fed the wrong encouragement. You've all watched those movies where the Chosen One can do anything if they believe in themselves.
He is the one.
I love The Matrix, but that message is asinine. When you pop out the womb, you ain't good at nothing.
You spout a bunch of crap, but this is crap that I can really get behind.
Not once did that have any meaning to me as a child until I saw Gurren Lagann as an adult. Simon started at the bottom as a wimp, now he's a jerk and everyone loves him. You think he's a failure because he goes home to Starla at night? He didn't succeed just because he believed in himself. That only gave him the aspiration to try, fail, see what he messed up on, and try again.
No matter what's in my way, I won't stop! Once I've dug through, it means that I've won!
Fight the power!
This is the message Gurren Lagann perfected. When you are the absolute worst at something, the only limit is rock bottom. If you practice, there is nowhere else to go but up.
Fight the power!
How can you speed? Where are you drawing all of this power from?
We evolve beyond the person we were a minute before. Little by little, we advance a bit further with each turn. That's how a drill works. And that's Tengen Toppa. That's Gurren Lagann. My drill is the drill that creates the heavens!
Row, row, fight the power! Row, row, fight the power!
We're gonna train!
Patty drags the recruit into a private room. It's time to screw.
Fly away now! Fly away now! Fly away!
Panty and stocking with garter belt. The only people who would be watching this crap are 5-year-olds and IQ 75 R-tards who thought Duke Nukem Forever was funny and laugh at the poopy jokes. My kinda show. How can I explain this? You get the Powerpuff Girls, Drawn Together, the WarioWare games, Zone Tan, drop all that into a blender, and you get this. In hindsight, putting all that into a blender would not result in anything of value. Hearing how this series was animated by Studio Gainax, known for Sega Genesis Lime Gelatin, Tangy Tasty Gooey Lagoon, and Fruity Tooty Ass and Booty, it's no surprise how insane this is.
He said I was the best fuck he had ever had. Way better than you. Not that he should procreate, but I would totally have his abortion.
You got this show of vanished anarchy angels named Panty and Stocking, who use what they're named after as weapons to battle demons like the Demon Sisters, Scanty, and Nisox. Nisox's best pony.
I'm too fragile, I blush easily.
As a white person, I choose to call the Anarchy Angels Twilight and Banana. Twilight Stocking represents gluttony, while Banana Panty is lust, and there's nothing wrong with that. We don't slut shame here, we slut appreciate. Everything about this show is just wrong.
Rub it into every fold, every single one.
Why?
Action, comedy, music video, silent cartoon, it's all over the place. I don't like shows being raunchy. What I like is when a show is funny and happens to be disgusting. So it's a real hit or miss of a series, mostly hit. If you're a G1 Transformers fan, they got the parody just for you.
You're not just a whore, you're a stupid whore.
You and your lame-ass fucking dick moves, I should have seen that coming.
The Stocking Cons escape trouble by donning diapers.
When it comes to war, anything goes. Kill the bitch!
What will Panty do?
It could have been the perfect spoof if they just said the line, Autococks, pull out. On the subject of giant robots, I'd say this is Japan's answer to Megas XLR, how it's an anime mocking American media. You heard right, PSG's considered an anime since it was created in Japan. So if I were to cook some spaghetti in America, it's no longer Italian food. I know they switched the style a few times, so did Horton Hears a Who, and that ain't no anime I ever heard of. They speak Japanese in Whoville? I don't understand this logic, but you can thank my love of this art style for making me sharper over the years. Studio Gainax loves to put most of their money and talent on some incredible scenes, while they had to sacrifice quality in others. You can forgive an episode for resorting to flash animation thanks to its simplicity. Could be worse. We are talking about the same company that blew their budget on Evangelion so hard, they had to finish the final episode using goddamn Crayola markers. In terms of audio, it's an almost exact English dub, but loses a few minor things in translation. The Japanese voices spouting English will be missed. The seductive way the Demon Sisters roll their R's is also absent. Given the choice, I go for the English dub. Hearing the banter is more fun than reading it on subtitles. It's just one of those animes that was meant for America.
God ain't even here right now. Prayer can go to hell, man. We got angels, Penny and Stark in Europe.
It's a brand new show. Market share, we in control. Slutty angels, how we roll. Got it showing high as low.
We are high class demon commanders.
The inception of Panty and Stocking with Garter Belt came when the creators watched Drawn Together, thinking it was the funniest thing in the world, which is not an opinion, but a goddamn fact. They proceeded to get drunk as they exchanged dirty jokes until the series was finalized. I am not making this up. A shame PSG crashed and burned in 13 episodes. Maybe someone should have told them Drawn Together was not very successful. Boy, these American cartoons sure are a hoot. Who would have guessed we'd be making these animes? Let's make our own interpretation of this one. A second season of Panty and Stocking was teased, but it's been 3 years later and nothing new but this Japanese coloring book has come up, ending the series on a plot twist cliffhanger that disappointed so many fans. First thing I gotta say, people actually cared about the plot? Really? I love the show, but someone actually gave a shit about the ending. Oh well, just like with Motor City's demise, I'm not worried. I can see this being a big hit, not on Toonami, but Adult Swim itself, considering their demographic.
Repent, motherfuckers! Suck on this, asshole!
I don't know when, but we'll see the return of Panty and Stocking, and Symbionic Titan, and Motor City, and Dead Man Wonderland, Thundercats, Mega6LR.
Oh dear! Sorry for the wait! I hope you guys are ready for a fucking party now!
So in the immortal words of Panty Stocking Anarchy!
Say it with me!
Repent, motherfuckers!
Shaolin Showdown is back on Disney XD. How many people even have that channel?
I have Disney XD.
I don't care. I hate when people type out Disney XD. You assume they're laughing, like, what are you laughing at, huh? Huh? Are you laughing at me? Is that what you're laughing at? Yeah. Yeah, walk away. Just keep walking. Just walk away. This revival, Shaolin Showdown Chronicles, is structurally the same show you watched a decade ago. A gang of Shaolin monks travel the world collecting mystical items. To decide whether the good or evil team keep the items, a Shaolin showdown commences. First one to call for a showdown comes up with the challenge. This could be anything from a race or a made-up game to compete in, which is such a flawed concept when one can easily proclaim whoever's wearing a yellow t-shirt wins. I win. How about first one to chop their own arm off and eat it wins? Like, imagine if the show just got real like that. I'm sorry, kids. You gotta do it. It's for the fate of the internet. We could have easily combined Shaolin Showdown with Saw. It's such a missed opportunity for a children's cartoon. This revival is like the 2008 Hulk movie or that last season of Dexter's Lab. Is it a continuation? Is it its own thing? Nobody knows. But it's gone through slight alterations. Redesigns, the kids can bend elements, Raimundo's no longer the leader like he was at the end of the first incarnation, the showdowns are in CGI with these out-of-place Tron suits. Here's what I don't get. The mystical items they collect have been renamed. Warner Brothers owns the exclusive rights to those titles. Orb of Tsunami is now Orb of Torpedo, Monkey Staff, Monkey Spear, Shroud of Shadow, Shroud of Monster Camel. Just let them use the names. They can use everything else. What sort of logic is this? Okay, we want you to make a Superman movie, but we don't ever want you to call him Superman. You may also be peeved by the replaced voice cast. I pass it off as the kids maturing into adults. They sound close enough to the old cast. This is now a Canadian production. There's a law that only Canadian citizens can work on a show produced there. No American voice actors unless they have dual citizenship. Now, I've been ignoring the elephant in the room. Oh, there's an elephant in the room! What? Tristan, get in here! Why is there an elephant in the room? How did this happen? How? Look at this now! So yeah, how do TV executives revitalize a long-running show? I reached out to the president of Cartoon Network, Stuart Snyder, and he had this to say.
I'll kidnap 1,000 children before I let this company die!
Ooh, my mistake. That was from one of Steve Jobs' iPhone presentations. To add life to an aging show, Rugrats included a new baby voiced by some woman named Tara Strong. Fairly Odd Parents added a baby voiced by Tara Strong. Now this show added a baby version of the protagonist, Omi, voiced by Tara Strong. You ask, who's this Tara Strong? Well, sorry, I just don't know. Some big voice actor, I guess. I think I met her once. I don't remember. Adding a fifth member, I wouldn't mind, except he's a baby clone version of the main character. They named him Ping Pong. His power is wood. Gave him big round glasses and a high-pitched voice, as if Omi wasn't racially insensitive enough. If you like the old series and don't mind some glaring changes, it's as if they never left, until you realize, wait, that Shaolin Showdown would never do that. What's going on here? Who are you? What did you do to Shaolin Showdown? Where is- Oh, no, it's over there. I can still watch the old episodes on YouTube, never mind. You have to ask yourself, is it better to continue the same show or do a separate continuity like with all these Ninja Turtles and Batman incarnations? If you try to do your own thing instead of replicating something else, people will accept it on its own merits rather than constantly compare the two, most of the time. Now, I am off to review Uncle Grandpa next. Hello everyone, I'm Pan Pizza, and I suck my own dick so you don't have to. My semester is over, so tonight I rented Adventure Time. Let's explore the dungeon because
I don't know!
If you're not familiar with the funny and sometimes emotional TV show this game is based on, it's that cartoon you hate because it's not from 1990 and it's too weird for you, unlike Ren and Stimpy. Or you just have a different opinion. This is the second game adaption, and what do you know? It's another retro throwback. Whoop-dee-doo!
Whoop-dee-doo!
I'm kinda getting tired of every Cartoon Network game being a throwback. The gameplay here is reminiscent of Diablo and Gauntlet. It's a four-player beat-em-up, collect treasures and kill monsters through 100 floors. It's like Sword Art Online, except you're not fucking your cousin.
Bombs!
There's a lot here for the fans. Enemies, weapons, and allies straight out of the series, with voices and writing from the crew themselves. You even get a story that contributes to the Adventure Time mythology.
So you're positive.
As a party game, check it out. But single player is the setback. Alone, I quickly grew tired of fighting every single monster and just raced to the finish line.
I'm outta here.
You wanna talk unbalanced? Marceline the Vampire Queen can float over pits. Yes, you do unlock other flying characters, but she's also immune to all red projectiles, which charge up her screen finisher. There is no point in playing anyone else. How can you resist the queen of the vampires? Kiss her. Kiss her. You ever realize we haven't seen any other vampires on the show, so really, Marceline ain't queen of shit.
Mama needs a hug.
Yeah, I bet you do. I want to see Marceline Marcicreen. Now, let me tell you about these locked gates. They require a key. How do you get the key? You can actually explore the dungeon because
I don't know!
Or just bump into the gate and this key keeper appears. Wow, that was a minor inconvenience. Look, you can waste a key to open this gate, or you could just float around it, you know, if you're an asshole. If that's not globbed up enough for you, you have to play through 5 or 10 floors in a row to keep all your treasure you found. Once you return to the hub, you must spend everything you earned. Re-entering the dungeon requires a candy tax, taking away all your money.
It's the law.
If you're one treasure short of buying an upgrade, tough shit, back into the dungeon, play again, your money is set back to 0, no trial, fuck you.
Unacceptable!
Playing through 10 floors in a row, not dying, getting every collectible, killing every monster, all for maybe one stat upgrade for one character, it doesn't make the game difficult, just time consuming. The money you earn in this game is so limited, I can't believe it's not free to play.
Fitness doesn't come cheap. You need to exercise that wallet a bit before I can help.
Because of how weak your default attack is, some of the bosses are near impossible, like Fiona and Cake. If you don't know, Fiona and Cake were created by this crazy old man for the intention to marry. They're female versions of the main characters, so this old man is expressing his sexual lust for gender bents of the 13, 14 year old boy, I don't know. This is the kind of boss where you die so many times, you are desperately trying every combination. After about 60 years of replaying the same boss, I found out you attack Cake the Cat first, then Fiona as they heal.
Are you remembering to use special attacks?
I keep doing this, but all my attacks are useless. I'm absorbing their red projectiles to use my screen finisher over and over. Nothing is working. What do I do? Am I supposed to kill the Ice King first? I don't know. Are they both healing or is it just Cake?
I don't know.
Are they healed up 100%?
I don't know!
Should I continue doing this?
I don't know!
crippled Christ on a crutch. You know what makes for a great but still difficult boss fight? Having a sense of progression. Show me a health bar or Marceline's tits, please. Typical games have the enemies altered for multiplayer. Not here. If it's good enough for four players, it's good enough for a single fighter.
What is this? I don't even...
The only way to beat this boss is if you had upgraded, have more than one person playing with you, or have a secondary weapon, which if you die in a boss battle, your weapon is lost. You have to quit and replay through four levels again and find a good melee weapon. Don't get the projectile weapons. They are useless.
You'll never defeat them with the pole. Just use your standard attacks.
Then what's the point of it, lady, if it can't kill enemies? Now, I admit, there's some pretty creative boss fights in this game.
Get away! You can't have my lumps!
But here is the end-all fuck-all, one of the worst bosses I've ever played. On level 50, you have to guess who's friendly by tapping these fart clouds. You can see if they're hostile, if they walk past the flickering light post, but you cannot attack them, so what's the point? You gotta take a chance and lose a beat of health no matter what. Unless one of the 50,000 blobs that happen to walk past these points are friendly. Revealing a monster causes a chain reaction, exposing others. Once you find a good guy, you slowly escort him to the exit. If any blobs get in your way, they'll start attacking in groups, scare off your escort, and quickly kill you because your default attack is weak as dicks.
Game logic.
So you gotta start all over until you successfully do this three times in a row. Then, you know what you do next? You know what you wanna do? You have to suck their balls. Suck their fucking balls, Marty. Do it, Marty. Do it for the fucking vine. And that is where I gave up on this game, mainly since I rented it so I had to turn it in. I was so fed up with this game, I looked up the ending online and crasturbated. Hey, you want me to spoil it? You sure?
Bitch! You bitch!
Nah, I won't spoil it. You all know I'm YouTube partnered with Frederator, who made this show in conjunction with Cartoon Network. After this video is posted, they're going to kill me. Well, no they won't, but I don't think they're gonna take too kindly to this video. So yeah, I actually kinda like this game.
Oh, ha ha, you pranked me hardcore.
Complaining about this game is like hating Mario Party for the single player. So ignore most of my complaints and come grab your friends. Most of these issues vanish in multiplayer. Though I warn you, the 3DS version does not have multiplayer.
Join me in imagining a better world of friendship, won't you?
I just wish they altered the solo campaign. Sure, I could make friends and invite them over to my ugly house, but I think this game is expecting a little too much out of me. Trying to make friends, that's life on hard mode. Now, if you excuse me, I'm gonna do the only fun thing I can do with this game by myself and shove it up my ass.
Excellent! You can store a lot of weapons in there.
Uncle Grandpa? More like Father Dad, cause that guy's a motherfucker! Oh, this show is so gross. What happened to clean, friendly 90s cartoons like Ren and Stimpy or Cow and Chicken? Oh wait, I already used that one. People are saying the Uncle Grandpa title encourages incest. Well, what happened to Mama had a chicken, Mama had a cow, Dad was proud, she didn't care how. You can have sex with all the farm animals you want, but when I want relations with my cousin, suddenly we got some problems. I'm the bad guy. Despite what you'd expect, this show is more non-sequitur random humor and almost no gross-out jokes. Uncle Grandpa and his gang of mental patients travel the world helping a different person because he's everybody's uncle and grandpa. It's like if Doctor Who was made by a below-average primate or an American. There is an episode where he's killing these alien fish, but it's been implied that he's related to non-humans. So, aren't those his family too? I can't believe it. Uncle Grandpa would kill his own kids. What a monster. No way are you able to describe the humor. It does whatever it wants and there's no rules. Storyboarding this must have been a lot of fun. I certainly find this show enjoyable on a mindless level. The show splits itself into segments. This sort of humor works better in smaller doses. Sometimes the skits focus on Uncle Grandpa and sometimes it's his friends like Pizza Steve, voiced by Adam of my current favorite live-action show, Workaholics. Go watch Workaholics, it's a regular show for adults. Pizza Steve's bed is made up of other pizzas who aren't alive, or at least not yet, so we can assume he sleeps on a bed of dead pizzas or unborn pizza fetuses. I'm looking at Pizza Steve's design, and is that supposed to look like what I think it is? Everyone is picking apart this show, but Cartoon Network is really putting a lot of faith into it. Every commercial break, Uncle Grandpa is coming this September. Uncle Grandpa, he is coming. In the gym, he is coming. He is coming in this general direction. I don't like it when my real grandparents show up. I just stay in my room avoiding contact, wishing I hoarded more snacks. This series was brought to you by Pete Browngard, who spawned Secret Mountain Fort Awesome, a cartoon that was more unapologetic in its repulsiveness. I kid you not, they played like 2 episodes of Fort Awesome and it vanished. It was the network's biggest failure since The Problem Solvers and Wulin Warriors!
Wulin! Wulin! Wulin Warriors!
How did they give this guy another show? Okay, you made a cartoon that totally bombed, but we'll give you another shot. Just don't make the characters unappealing.
What did I tell you? What did I tell you?
I just don't know what went wrong.
You knew exactly what went wrong.
This, I believe, is why Billy and Mandy lasted longer than its sister show, Evil Con Carne. Maybe more people would give Uncle Grandpa a chance if they paired him up with a regular girl who is either cynical or cowardly towards Uncle Grandpa. Make a show as weird as you want, but you gotta give the viewer someone to latch onto who is relatable and appealing. No overly thick accents or inhuman figures. I recommend Uncle Grandpa, but I know not many will give it a shot. Now, coming up next on Rebel Taxi, I got a lot more side missions to review for so many new cartoons coming in, a top 10 hopefully, and here's a surprise, I'll be doing an interview. Maxwell Adams, the creator of the grim adventures of Billy and Mandy, has agreed to talk with me. He's developing a new project called Dead Meat. More info on his Tumblr.
You're gonna interview the creator of Billy and Mandy and you haven't even reviewed that show?
I know, it's messed up, right? Everyone post your questions in the YouTube comments. He said he was open for anything. Billy and Mandy, a particular episode, Dead Meat, his career. If you're gonna ask something stupid and off topic, at least include a legit on topic question so I'm not spammed with gibberish. Let's all hope my social anxiety doesn't kick in during this interview.
This is my best idea ever.
Probably no one special.
Sorry this video took so long, but I finally got my guest tonight. Introduce yourself, Maxwell Adams, the creator of Cartoon Network's Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy.
I'm Maxwell Adams, the creator of Cartoon Network's Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy.
Maxwell has agreed to answer the questions you posted in my Uncle Grandpa review. Now, without further ado, question one is by the Cartoon Gamer 8000. Where'd the idea for Booby and Mandy come from?
I think it all kind of came from my childhood fascination with monsters and just sort of freaky stuff and the occult.
It seems to be a swirling vortex of pure evil coming out of your floor.
I had done a film in college just called Billy and Mandy. Billy was actually drilling a hole in his head to let his inner demons out. Completely inappropriate for Cartoon Network. I felt like Billy and Mandy were fun characters, but there was something missing, and that turned out to be Grimm, and it just sort of went from there.
Yeah! And now you're our best friend forever!
Fortunately, somebody at Cartoon Network decided that was a good idea. I don't know how it happened, but I'm not going to complain.
Do you still have that college short film?
Yeah, it's actually on film in my closet, and I have no way to watch it, but I should probably get that transferred at some point.
And Sega Man 123 wants to know your favorite Billy and Mandy episode.
I don't know, I have a special place in my heart for Ecto Cooler.
We're not wieners and sissies! We're all the Dundies! And we're gonna kick your butt!
When you're running a show, you don't often have time to do a lot of your own episodes, so that one was just sort of all me, and I just like that it's got Lord Byron in it. It's kind of weird.
Your words will be as 10,000 arrows in his buttocks.
Pat Hazard is curious on how did you get involved with the artist Volturi.
My friend and I used to go to goth clubs. I thought Volturi was hilarious, so he ended up having a show out here. And after the show, I just came over and said, hey, I really like your work. And he somehow knew who I was, so we sort of struck up a bit of a friendship over that.
So why does Grimm have a Jamaican accent? Najizh1101 asks.
My original idea was that Grimm was going to be British, and he was going to be sort of like Dr. Smith from Lost in Space.
I shall quell this frightful creature with my cold and unvarying stare.
And we actually had Dr. Smith from Lost in Space come in, and it just didn't feel right. And finally, when Greg Eagles came in, he ended up just sort of doing a... sounded sort of Jamaican, and I was like, whoa, do more of that. And eventually, I sort of fell in love with that take on it.
I am the Grim Reaper, man. I possess supernatural powers! It's all here in the Destruction Man.
In that period, Cartoon Network had shorts bundled within other cartoons. How come Billy and Mandy's counterpart, Evil Concarne, split into its own series?
My name is Hector Concarne, and I will one day rule the world!
I think it was better when we split them up. Trying to have two completely different shows with completely different casts is a little rough if you want to do both of them justice. And it just seemed like so much work that we said, well, okay, we'll do one last season of Evil and make it the best we can, and then we'll just continue with Billy and Mandy.
Steven Horde would like to hear your opinion on the Billy and Mandy video game.
I got together with the game company, and we sort of talked about the games that we liked. And, you know, when Power Stone came up, everyone was like, yeah, I like Power Stone. So, you know, the nature of the show is they're friends, but they're always sort of fighting. So I thought it'd be fun just to have, you know, Billy, Mandy, Grimm beating each other up.
But what kind of sickle would make us fight just for their own amusement?
Yeah, I thought it came out great.
I thought it was one of the best cartoon to game adaptations. What about Punch Time Explosion, the Cartoon Network crossover fighter?
Billy and Mandy versus Samurai Jack.
You know what? I got it. They sent me one for PlayStation, and I don't have a PlayStation, so I haven't played it, but I've seen some videos online, and it looked cool.
Dandy269 wonders if there were any adult jokes you weren't allowed to sneak in.
To be continued.
Don't worry, part 2 will be up a little after Maxwell's Kickstarter project has launched. And my nose is gone. Look, it could have been worse. It could have been a story within the review. Now, on with the Maxwell Adams interview. Dandy269 wonders if there were any adult jokes that were rejected.
Don't make me go medieval on you.
As I was saying.
There was a line where Billy's dad was in the kitchen and there was a giant snake trying to eat him. And he said something about how a snake was trying to eat his Bismarck. So they were like, no, you can't say Bismarck. And I was like, what is the world coming to?
According to Urban Dictionary, a Bismarck is... Oh, no, I'm not reading this. Since we're talking about mature humor, Austin Tingle and I swears that Yogi Bear appeared in an episode and said the word bastard. Did we hear that correctly?
Look, I really got to get going.
Hey, that's cool, man. Give me that bastard.
No, I think he says basket.
Bastard.
There's a few things like that. There's something General Scar says where everybody always thinks he says shit, but he doesn't.
What was the hardest episode to do, asked by Mr. Valierger?
If you want to call it an episode, it would be Big Boogie Adventure for sure, because we had to do it on top of the regular schedule, so that made it extra challenging. But anything where we had to double up like that, which was usually the specials.
How did that guy from the jury get on my ship?
I need to make poo-poo! I need to make poo-poo real bad!
Next one's by Cartoon Dude 29. How did Fred Burger came to be, and also his episode Keeper of the Reaper?
It should be me who's the Keeper of the Reaper.
Grimm's not a toy for an idiot boy who can't even tie his shoes.
That belongs to C.H. Greenblatt. He came to me one day and said, hey, I have this idea. And I was like, okay, just do whatever. Because by that point, he'd done so many amazing, hilarious boards that I had a good feeling about it. And he pitched it. And immediately I was like, okay, you have to do the voice for this guy.
So the guy who made Chowder came up and voiced Fred Fredberger.
Yep.
My name is Fred Fredberger. I'm on TV, and sometimes I like TV shows that have monkeys.
No!
Yes!
This comment's by GR8 Crew. How did the crossover with Kids Next Door occur? I know you're friends with the creator, Mr. Warburton.
You know, we met by the copy machine and sort of developed a friendship that lasted throughout both of our series. And when it got toward the end, Cartoon Network was really sort of into doing cross-promoting. So we thought, hey, let's do a crossover.
Those pants are not coming off.
Obsession Chick asks if you ever read Grim Tales, a fan webcomic featuring your characters.
Yes, I did. I did see some of that. That guy can draw like crazy. I only wish I could draw like that. Some beautiful, beautiful stuff.
Ed Mower is asking, what's that backwards voice in the end credits?
What is the message? I ain't gonna give that away.
Well, thanks for nothing.
No, this is the end of the show. You want it backwards?
Herp Derp, whatever happened to the TV movie Underfist, which united Billy and Mandy side characters into a superhero group? Wasn't it supposed to be a series?
Okay, you play nice now.
Yes, Mommy.
Brett, that was right sort of at the end of an era for Cartoon Network. Their parent company changed management, which was Turner, and that rolled over to Cartoon Network. So new people came in and said, hey, we don't really want to do any of this old stuff. And they decided to make live action shows, and that didn't go too well, which is, you know, why at the same time, you know, Craig McCracken, myself, pretty much everybody ended up leaving Cartoon Network.
You moved on to work at Disney. How was that?
You know, there's people that love Disney and they belong there. I'm not one of them. I think the style of doing stuff at Cartoon Network was just sort of guerrilla warfare, and you just did what you had to do to get it done. Disney is very much more specific on the way that they like to do things, and their brand is so rock solid that, you know, it is sort of restricting for me anyway.
Not as much creative control?
Right.
So, Maxwell, what's this new project, Dead Meat?
Get ready for cruel and unusual comedy. 80s-style action movie action. Cool new characters. Crazy cars. Romance. Freaky mutants. Genital torture.
Dead Meat is something completely different for me. My homage to my favorite 80s action movies, and also social satire with lots and lots of puppet gore.
So it's a grungy, violent, effects-heavy puppet show. What's it about?
It's about this dog named Dead Meat and his master, James Heckler. Heck is a mutant hunter. Dead Meat is a dog, but he's also a mutant, so they have sort of this strained relationship. Everything changes when another mutant comes between them, and that's the battle priestess Suzuki Jackson, who's prophesied to destroy the human race, and Dead Meat falls in love with her, and that sort of forms this strange love triangle that threatens to tear the characters apart and possibly the entire world.
Come for the exploding puppets.
Stay for the characters and the comedy.
When it's done, where can people watch it?
The idea is to just, you know, put it up on the internet and get as many people as I can to watch it.
Any chance for Billy and Mandy making a cameo?
Oh, well, I don't want to spoil any surprises, but who knows, maybe.
We're all dead meat.
Hey, is this an audio interview, or?
And we're out of time. If you'd like to see the full uncut interview, you can eat my ass, or you can click the link in the description. Also included down there are Maxwell's Tumblr and the Kickstarter to Dead Meat to support his independent web series.
All I got is a quarter and...
Me need money!
If it's fully funded, I'll actually get around to reviewing Ed, Edd n Eddy. If it isn't, I'm going back to the nose. Oh, I forgot to ask if he'd ever like to return to Billy and Mandy if he had the chance. Luckily, he answered it on his blog. Here's what he wrote. There you go. Happy Halloween. I'm Pan Pizza, reminding you that you're gonna fucking die one day. Guys. guys, my videos are always late. I'm a disorganized mess. I don't want to go to college and work anymore. I want to go to California and become a character designer or a pro skater. Whatever. Cartoon Network has made like Orange Juice Simpson and Killed Level Up, replacing it with The Incredible Crew. If the show was called The Incredible Jew, it definitely would be more cost-effective. It's a sketch show, very much like The Amanda Show or All That. Hate to say it, but All That and most of the 90s live-action Nick shows don't hold up too well. I put this in the same league as Mad. Some skits are really funny and some have no point. One is simply a guy wearing boxing gloves tied to lunchboxes as he hits a punching bag, and they call it lunchboxing. Like, wow guys, did you even try? I think the writers were just saying, hey, you have any jokes? No? Too bad. To change it up, they got some hidden camera pranks that are just embarrassing. Embarrassing like servers singing happy birthday to you at a restaurant. Like, what are you supposed to do? Do you just sit there? Do I sing along too? Internet Vlogger and Chicken McNugget, Pie Guy Rules, summed up the issue with this show.
On YouTube, you just click, click, click. Okay, that one, not that one, that one, not that one. You choose what you want to watch.
The internet killed off most sketch shows. Why sit through 30 minutes of a mixed bag when you can jump into all the good ones online? You can credit the defecation creation of Incredible Crew to Nick Cannon. Does anyone know what Nick Cannon does? I think he was in a movie. Casted in this crew is the voice of Finn the Human in person, Jeremy Shada.
Sha-la-la-la.
Just for that, I believe the target audience are fangirls who just love Jeremy Shada. I would look down on those little fangirls, but I'm not a pervert, and if they were to dress Jeremy and J.G. Quintel, the voice of Mordecai and regular show creator, as their characters to host some sort of event in person, that would be so much fun. I think the most humorous thing this show ever gave us was this promotional poster of Jeremy going balls first into this dog's mouth. Bless that crazy bastard. Now, you ask in your infinite stupidity, why does Cartoon Network keep pushing live action? Well, let's be thankful this is their only live action show now, and simply because it's more cost effective to film, or let's say, import a low budget Canadian cartoon. It's not as bad as what Nick did recently with the new Nick Studio 10 block. It's the same as Incredible Crew, except they just pop into other shows already in progress, show a random skit or internet clip, and shout, Nick did it, and cut back to regular programming while you missed out on what happened in between. Why? If you check their Facebook, they're talking trash on Incredible Crew, trying to get a rivalry going. It's like two bums fighting over a moldy sandwich. No wait, that would imply they'd achieve something. I'd say it's more of a sperm race at an abortion clinic. They got 96 likes on Facebook. For something on TV, that is pathetic. I have more likes than them, and I'm not even internet famous. Although I am somewhat internet famous enough to know that giving out my Skype name to 12,000 subscribers was probably not a good idea at all. How about we look into Nickelodeon's forums and check out their fan base? If you like Nick Studio 10, be my friend. I think we found the saddest comment on the internet. Nick Studio 10's attitude on Facebook is just, look at us, we're so extreme. Genocide does what Nigeria don't. Alas, poor Billy, they made a final update about going away for a while until April to get retooled. Yeah, I bet that attitude of yours changed pretty quickly. I don't see that or Incredible Crew surviving, so I say things are looking up right about now for animation news. Cartoon Network is now on Netflix Instant Stream. Toonami filed 6 months of paperwork to get IGPX to rerun again. No word on Megas, so they say that's a whole different process to get working. If I'm gonna do my Toonami Retrospect Part 3 in honor of Tom 5 coming, I don't know, I'm so disorganized now. But hey, did you hear? Warner Brothers is working with a website called SMGO to maybe fundraise a revival to Young Justice and Green Lantern. I hope this opens doors for fans to kickstart failing TV shows. Now, it's time for me to tuck myself in. Before I attempt such an act, some random fan interviewed me, so search Wordy the Animator on YouTube. My internet friend is making a stupid-ass sketch show called Bobby Logic. Help him out. He has connections to stuff. And I want you all to follow my stupid webcomic I have to do for class called Loki IRL. It's like drawn together, crapped out Avatar Last Airbender. Now I have some pony fucking videos coming up, or Tony Hawk Under the Sea, I don't know what's next. I have school and work. So I shall ride off into the sunset with this song on how I feel. I dedicate this to you, Level Up, a guilty pleasure you were for me.
Just wanna play video games, cause everything else is really lame.
Shall we play a game?
Oh.
Time for another video game analogy. She wins, flawless victory, fatality.
Movies based on video games tend to fall into the category of what the fuck. But what about movies based around the concept of games? And that's what I'm counting down.
All right, let's boot it up.
No TV shows with a few video game episodes. From the ground up, it must be about video games without directly being based on one. Oh. These are my top 10 movies and TV shows for gamers. Like any list, don't expect everything to fit inside 10 rankings in your ultra-specific order. But if you want to avoid disagreement when making a top 10, the only winning move is not to play. By the way, War Games did not make it on the countdown.
Wait, what?
It's Juice and Jam time!
I'm taking this to the next level!
Sylvester Stallone was in Spy Kids?
I come from the net to this place. Mainframe.
Before Toy Story and Beast Wars, Canada gave us the first CG animated TV series, Reboot. It was Tron of the 90s, good and evil play a game for the fate of the internet.
Warning, incoming game.
Yeah, its graphics are laughable now, but from what started as a fun kid show, grew darker and darker. Rainmaker Entertainment, who animated this and the upcoming Ratchet and Clank film, are interested in giving this a reboot.
Wow, that's pretty ironic.
It's not ironic, it's coincidental.
I am a renegade, lost on the net.
Reboot! Back in the day, I played Nintendo. Controller in my hand, I'm going commando.
A pinnacle moment of the Reagan era, The Wizard. How do you hype up the release of a major Nintendo title?
Ninja Gaiden! Hey!
Make a film where Fred Savage of the Wonder Years kidnaps a kid with mental disorders and exploits him to win a video game tournament featuring... It's so 80s, look at that guy, he's not playing a game, he's living the game.
You get to your station!
The Wizard is nothing but one big cheesy Nintendo commercial, and that's what's so great about it.
It's so bad.
Adam is from Mars, Morgan is from Venus.
I love to route you messages with my tiny penis.
G4 was the one and only channel for tech enthusiasts. My favorite programs were the retrospect series Icons, the pixelated raunchy comedy Code Monkeys, and for reviews, X-Play together with Reviews on the Run. Those two were some of the reasons I'm making videos.
Wow.
It was all good up until gamers started getting all their news and reviews from the internet instantly. The once all gaming channel devolved into reruns of Cops, Star Trek, and wow, episodes of Lost, years after cancellation, and everyone knew they made it up as they went along. TV killed the radio star, but YouTube teabags on G4's remains.
Stay with you until the bitter end.
How high can you get? Aw yeah! The King of Kong documentary is a brutal look at competitive gaming. Steve Wiebe versus Billy Mitchell for world's greatest Donkey Kong player. Recognize this guy, regular show fans?
Oh, Billy Mitchell always has a plan.
Donkey Kong is as basic as an arcade cabinet could be, but could you have guessed how much strategy it has?
Okay, the secret about the barrel board is you can actually control the barrels.
The day Donkey Kong invades America, Steve Wiebe will guide us to victory.
Most would scoff at such dedication to a game, but the King of Kong is an example that you can have passion for your hobbies and still be a well-adjusted person.
Why do we do it? Because we actually love this, because we enjoy this. We're fascinated by this. It's just something in our genes.
Suck it Sammy, jerk it Jerry, chug it Charlie, fuck it Freddy, abort it Amy, Wreck it Ralph is the Toy Story of video games. What are these characters up to when no one's playing? You'd assume the adorable ones would be nice. No, they're fucking assholes.
I don't want to be the bad guy anymore.
All these arcade poster boys together, I want more crossovers. Imagine Wreck-It Ralph meeting both Tron and Sora of Kingdom Hearts. Whose world is the real world?
Finish the game! No!
Yes!
Bust out your bong, this is Tron. Look at all these colors, holy crap. You got the 82 film and the extended Daft Punk music video, Tron Legacy.
We gotta work together!
But you may be oblivious to the overlooked animated series, Tron Uprising, serving as a bridge between the films. It aired next to the also short-lived Motor City. It may have aged poorly and become slow in the middle, but Tron in general is just the perfect thing to watch at night. It's the ultimate blacklight poster.
Welcome to the land of Oz.
So War Games did not make it on the list.
Fuck you.
Yeah, I bet you wanna fuck me. It's not on the list because Summer Wars is War Games with a bit of Digimon the movie spliced in.
You can't just go around doing whatever you like because you're online. There are rules, you know.
Question, how do we prevent nuclear disaster and create world peace? Blame it on the foreigner? No, everyone in your family has to play video games. The most colorful and tear-jerking in the countdown, Summer Wars is scientific evidence the casual gaming market will save the world.
It's just a game, isn't it?
Any gamer that'll tell you he'll survive a zombie apocalypse is so full of shit and Mountain Dew, but when the time comes to pilot a giant robot, Megas XLR justifies our lifetime of training.
How did you get to be such a good pilot?
Well...
This cartoon appeals to the MTV-hating, kaiju-loving, retro gamers in every aspect. It's just a lot of fun. Megas had the short lifespan of a Dreamcast, but animation studio Titmouse is slowly but surely developing a revival.
Nice. This is the beginning of the song.
In Toronto, Canada, life's a game and there are no rules, only hipsters. Part musical, part tournament fighter, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World did a great job condensing the coloring book series into a movie that combined so many concepts you'd never thought could work in unison. What I envy the most is this here is an action movie with actual choreography, no close-up shaky cams. Michael Cera is an action star now. We truly are living in the future.
Everyone's an amateur when they first start. We all get laughed at by our teachers, and we all get laughed at by our upperclassmen. It's part of becoming a pro.
You may envy someone's success, but rarely do you see the struggle it took to get them there. Disregarding Phil Fish is a terrible person? Number one is a tie between the documentary Indie Game the Movie and Welcome to the NHK, which is Indie Game the Movie, the Anime, Z. These two cover the creation of Super Meat Boy, Fez, Braid, in a Japanese porn game, you'd assume simple games means easy to make, right?
You're four, you want to make games. It just seems like, oh, you just come up with ideas and then you have a game. It's awesome.
These are people who struggle through financial problems, broken relationships, anxiety, uncertainty of the future and their own product in hopes of reaching success. Dedication turns them into shut-ins, or hikikomoris in the exotic language of anime.
Even if I seclude myself in my room, as long as I'm striving to accomplish something, I'm not a hikikomori.
They're not admirable for their victory. The determination to finish what they started is what I love about them. Except you. Anyone striving for success? Indie Game and NHK is what you need to watch.
Things that are personal have flaws. They have vulnerabilities.
If you don't see a vulnerability in somebody, you're probably not relating with them on a very personal level.
Game over. The user wins.
Hello, everypony. Did you all have an incredible crew year's eve? Fuck. That's a review for another time. So, you know the animation studio Frederator? Animators of Fairy Odd Parents and Adventure Time? They got a YouTube channel called Cartoon Hangover offering original cartoons like The Bravest Warriors, their most popular series. Well, Hangover's been around since 2009, so it's their first anyone cared about. A shit has been gift wrapped? A shit has been given. People care now. Do you like Adventure Time? Yes or no? Okay, we're done here. Everyone go home. Bravest Warriors is a good show. It's just the exact same as Adventure Time with a slight bit more raunch. Cartoon Hangover prides itself in being edgy and extreme, although not too edgy. It's for the kids. Happy little kids. Too blank for TV. Aw yeah, a censored middle finger. Can't do that on television. Genesis does what Nintendo don't. Warriors is enjoyable without trying too hard to be crude for the sake of being crude, unlike most of Hangover. The other cartoon, Superfuckers, I can't say much for now. The first of the episodes are horrendous, but they got pretty hilarious by the fourth. Give them a chance to find their footing. Its creator's webcomic, American Elf, I absolutely love. It's a very sweet and sometimes very disturbing comic based on real events. I should really make a video on that and a certain other webcomic sometime.
I'm sorry, Ellie. You can't nurse on Mummy anymore. But I guess you can nurse on Daddy if you want. Ha ha. Lick. It was yummy? Mmm.
Yeah, it kinda gets weird sometimes. Yeah. Pendleton Ward created The Warriors and Adventure Time for Nickelodeon years ago, only to get rejected in favor of Fanboy and Chum Chum. Nickelodeon will regret that for the rest of their life. Penn has very limited involvement with The Warriors web show, doing just a few voices here and there, but it's still totally the same show. A blue guy with blonde hair aspiring to be a hero who has an awkward crush on a girl while his orange friend eggs him on about it. The orange friend is in a relationship with a weird animal. An old man with memory problems hangs around. They just had some unfinished Adventure Time scripts lying around. It's so similar to what came before for something that's still being made. This is where I coined the phrase Tough Puppy Syndrome in reference to how similar the Tough Puppy cartoon is to Fairy Odd Parents. And judging by the people who come up with ideas for this series, it's not the only syndrome this show suffers. Thank you, that was tonight's roast of Frederator Studios, the dislike bar is to your left. Not much else to say. Good show, it's Call of Duty Adventure Time. A shameless rehash and requires the internet for enjoyment. It certainly is TV quality animation on par with Adventure Time. The episodes are only 5 minutes long, so I'd be psyched to see an animation studio try making a Clone Wars microseries sort of thing. I myself am slow in the process of making that. And with my limited animation experience, it is gonna suck. Before I'm out, I gotta tell you all, Ringo Starr of the Beatles on his YouTube page confirmed the new Powerpuff Girls special and/or reboot for 2013. According to this picture, he will be doing the voice of a fruit.
And my beautiful octopi's gone! Oh, I love math!
And I'd like to promote the AsronComics.com, a fan of mine who makes comics, and my internet friend who makes internet video party on YouTube. It's an abomination. Go watch it.
Hey, can I get a shout out?
No. At the dawn of every TV show, only one episode is produced. This is called a pilot. It is the main factor whether or not a company will want to fund more episodes.
Darn it! What are we gonna do for cash now?
Sometimes the best ones don't go beyond their test run, and that's what I'm counting down. This was a hard list to choose, but it all boils down to what I want more out of.
Yay! My favorite!
Pro-choice, pro-life, Forget stupid babies and telling women what they can and can't do. We gotta save unborn TV shows. These are my top 10 failed animated pilots. It's Jews in Jerusalem time.
What could possibly go wrong?
Go away. What the fuck is this? Before importing Sailor Moon from Japan, America attempted to remake their own, half animated, half live action, some CGI. Look, we know it was gonna suck. She's not even hot in this version. But don't you want it to succeed, just so we can look back on it and laugh? Yeah, you do.
Thank you for not doing that.
This is me. I'm Vern. One day I'll become the greatest explorer in the world.
I think every graphic designer can agree. The Amazing World of Gumball is visual pornography. Cartoon Network Europe's other attempt at a series was Vern on Vacation. A child with neglectful parents leave him to die with farm animals who have yet to eat him, and hijinks ensue.
Drink me!
A bit juvenile? I don't care. I just want to look at it. Three Dog Band. It follows three dogs, they have a band, Three Dog Band. Oh my god. If you grew up on classic Cartoon Network, you're already familiar with Paul Rudish. Dexter, Powerpuff, Samurai, Too Stupid, he storyboarded your childhood. Three Dog Band was his attempt at a musical series. It's a fairly recent pilot with the style of the early 2000 network era.
Are you seeing all this deliciousness?
Yeah, cupcakes.
Why was this puppy euthanized before it could see? I put my money on the protagonist's voice.
Of course, of course. Look at this already in the morning.
Having such a thick accent alienates the viewer. At least that's my theory.
A man of a barbaric age may be the only key to his survival. Korgoth.
When you get the storyboard artist for SpongeBob and the creator of Samurai Jack together, I think this is exactly what you'd expect. Korgoth of Barbaria is just the nastiest, unapologetic tribute to Conan and Heavy Metal magazine. Adult Swim loved it so much they aired the pilot on TV a few times, but it was just too expensive to make more episodes.
Another adventure draws to a close.
Prepare for battle, dead one. You'll face defeat at the hands of the Zaboos!
If you manage to complete the ungodly task of waking up before 2 p.m. on a Saturday, oh my god, what is wrong with you? You may have seen the early morning DC Nation block showcasing animated shorts during commercials. This was where Teen Titans Go started, so I'm counting these as pilots. Take your pick, everyone wants something different. The most popular seem to be Plastic Man, Super Best Friends Forever, and my favorite, Amethyst, Princess of Gem World. Basically, it's Legend of Zelda.
It's dangerous to go alone. Take this.
I'd just be happy for a 30-minute compilation series if it means extending all their time limits. I want another Oh Yeah Cartoons.
Did you see that? I totally saved that cow.
I'm Agent Zero, Master of Disguise.
Cartoons with a female lead are a rarity. The Modifiers could have been a stylish successor to My Life as a Teenage Robot. To be honest, I was not impressed with the humor, but the British mod fashion, I can't resist the designs.
We work around the clock to foil the evil schemes of Baron Vane and his Goonie Legion of henchmen.
No clue why it was rejected when The Mighty Bee was greenlit a year later, so maybe it's not because of the lead girl, Agent Zero.
You don't believe in monsters, do you?
Whether it be Gravity Falls, Paranorman, or Psychonauts, there's a dedicated following for kids in paranormal situations. MTV's Dead Time Stories could have fit in that inner circle.
Have you been having insane fits again?
No.
Okay, yeah, the animation is limited, but it works as a storybook style, and you could really appreciate the atmosphere. Reasons for not getting greenlit? It's MTV, what do you expect?
I now call this meeting of the Elptingville Comic Book Club officially to order.
Welcome to Elptingville!
We are the Comical Gang!
If you're a fan of the Anime Club webcomic, then I got the pilot for you. Welcome to Eltingville is nothing but geek humor and an art style reminiscent of Clerks Animated. The reason it's not a series? Normal people don't know what they're talking about.
Who designed Space Ghost?
Alex Stoth. What year did Soylent Green take place?
2022. Co-feature with I Eat Your Skin.
I Drink Your Blood. Tintin Stock.
At the time of production, Adult Swim was only offering 15-minute flash cartoons. Eltingville was just too expensive. At the very least, there's the comic this pilot's based on, Dork, written by Evan Dorkin. Dorkin, that's his last name, that poor man.
You know what this means, don't you? This means the end of the Eltingville Club!
Hey, these Doritos are still good.
I'm gonna make things right! Power
Yeah. I am not stopping until Lakewood Plaza Turbo becomes some sort of cult hit amongst gamers. Adventure Time meets Street Fighter meets Dragon Ball. If that don't get you excited, then go fuck yourself. Ian Jones-Courtley, the creator, is still working at Cartoon Network. It's gonna happen someday. Uncle Grandpa's pilot was online for 4 years till it was greenlit into a show. You just freaking wait.
Go, KO! Go out and defend our plaza to the extreme! My soul burns for justice!
The most anime on Saturday outside of Japan. Tsunami, the Rising Sun.
2001, anime's popularity peaked in the West, and every kid owned a How to Draw manga book.
Hey, I love anime!
Yeah, and manga!
It truly was a horrible time to be alive.
Garugamesh!
America wanted a cut of the anime domination. Henceforth, Constant Pain was pitched. A youngling and her protective father fight crime in unison. Sure, you got the action, but also the comedy from their banter.
Come on, Dad, just
nope,
let me drive
nope,
this one
no
time.
Way.
I promise I'll never
no,
ask again.
No, you're not old enough to drive.
I'm 14, that's old
not
enough.
Not in this house.
Look at those goggles, it's so anime. The dialogue just feels genuine. Common speculation led some to believe it was never picked up for this vague resemblance to 9/11. But in reality, Michael Wright, the creator and writer, was attempting to unionize artists for better wages and work hours. And Nickelodeon said, hell no.
Why do you always do that?
Because I can play fair.
Hey, can I have some better wages and work
nope,
hours?
Sorry.
I've been up since
nope,
3 a.m.
Sorry.
Animating
mm-hmm,
this game.
Mm-hmm. Nope, you don't need that
and
money.
I haven't
nope,
seen my family
sorry,
in 5 weeks.
Not in this company.
Can I,
nope.
Can I get my stapler back?
R.I.P., you pilots. You'll live on in a better place. The internet. It's about time Regular Show had a video game. Mordecai and Rigby trapped in 8-bit land, only on 3DS. This one's by WayForward, the same guys who gave you last year's Adventure Time game. It's a run-and-jump platformer with the ability to switch characters. Rigby can crawl under tight spaces, Mordecai can double-jump. He's a bird, but he can't fly, which is really sad. Well, Mordecai can still double-jump. My friend told me when he was a child, he tried to double-jump in real life. I don't know how he thought it was possible. Within the platforming segments, you'll switch between a top-down and a space shooter. The three modes are as basic as possible, but the trick here is you have to alternate during gameplay. A fun mechanic that's difficult in all the right ways. This is meant to be a retro game throwback. Even in that aesthetic, the graphics are uninteresting. Though I do admire Rigby's walking animation. Oh yeah, look at him waddle. Go, Rigby! Protect the Americas from terrorists and the gay agenda. The 3D is pointless and so is the touchscreen, but the music and difficulty is where it's at. It's yell at the screen difficult. You want a challenge? Let's see you play a video game based on a children's program if you're man enough. It's a good kind of difficulty, like, yeah, I just spent 2 hours trying to beat the final boss. What did you do today? Taxes?
Ooh, look at me! I have a job!
Get this. One-hit kill bosses. I am so thankful the intense final battle has a midway checkpoint.
Thank you!
Thank you, you're an angel.
Yes, 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 I am. There, there. Give him one more.
One hit will take you out, unless equipped with the only power-up, cut-off shorts and a mullet. This doubles your health and you can shoot lasers, which is exactly how getting a mullet works in real life. For regular show fans, there's not much here for you. The only bit of story dialogue is in the intro and ending text. The repetitive enemies and power-ups are lifted from the show, but that's about it. You don't even see Margaret or the other park employees except Benson. Not a single voice clip or a cheesy 80s song. It feels empty to me. If this were double the length, I'd highly recommend it. But as is, wait for a discount. That's all for this game. Coming up next, a Steven Universe review. Will Google stop being a huge tool and cease forcing their failed social media site on us by the next video? Not very likely, but tune in to be disappointed. Okay, we're gonna talk about Rick and Morty on Adult Swim.
Congratulations, you won.
Oh my god, Nintendo 64. It's my first Adult Swim review, and it's a lazy-ass video log. What a waste. On the subject, the best way to describe Rick and Morty is Back to the Future, Shit Gets Real Edition. Rick is a drunk, abusive scientist who drags his nephew Morty along for experiments. Let me sum up an episode. Morty, it's science time.
No.
Science time, Morty.
No, please.
We're gonna do the science.
No.
Morty. The style of humor in this show is getting a cliche or something cartoony and giving it real-world consequences. Example, a freeze ray anywhere else would stop a person in place. In Rick and Morty, if someone tips a frozen person over, they're dead. Often, I don't know if I should feel sympathy, laughter, or disgust. It's crude, but really clever. Spoofing is how Rick and Morty started. This series existed as far back as 2006. As far as I know, there's two really crude animated shorts I'll link below.
Look what I found outside our house, Marty.
Oh no, it's real.
Scott, it's real, Marty. It's real!
No, it's not just a comic book. Oh god, it's real!
Get ready!
Rick and Morty was produced by the voice actor for Lemon Grab, Justin Roiland, and Dan Harmon, the creator of Community. So, just from that, this is already one of the most funniest and self-aware things Adult Swim ever produced. I have to recommend something else they did together. It's called Mr. Sprinkles from the live-action Acceptable TV sketch show. Anyone watch that? Anyone see Acceptable TV on VH1? Okay, Mr. Sprinkles is kinda like this. It's a sadistic Cat in the Hat spoof. I'll link it to you, but take note, it has the same plot points as The Dark Knight Rises 5 years before the movie. Christopher Nolan ripped Mr. Sprinkles off, that convoluted bastard.
Science rules.
Yeah. I don't know about you, but Rick and Morty to me seems like a Cartoon Network show for some reason. Maybe it's the thin outline art style, or maybe it's Mabley. I don't know. Its visuals are simple, but you may see some interesting environment or creature designs if you believe hard enough. Adult Swim's really rooting for this cartoon, shoving promotions everywhere. Right now, you can play the free point-and-click flash game on their site, Rick and Morty Rushed License Adventure.
This is just a licensed game, Morty. It's a licensed game. It had to be made quick.
They didn't even have to put voices, but that's how much they cared that they did put voices.
I got a sock! Did I do it? Did I win the game?
No, Morty, don't be an idiot.
I'm glad to see so many people are into Rick and Morty. I've seen a few complaints by viewers who are immediately turned off by the pupils, which is such a pointless complaint since you only see the close-ups for a few seconds. Unless maybe these people have really good TVs. Oh, poor you and your HD TV and well-paying job you really worked hard for and or parents' money. Boo-hoo. Boo-hoo. Do I recommend that you watch Rick and Morty? Yes. Well, I'm finished with that bare bones review. If anyone's wondering, I'm still working on that Ed and Eddie review script. I have no idea when it'll be done, but it'll be worth it. Same goes for my webcomic, Loki IRL.
It's a comic book! It's not real life, Marty! It's just a comic book, Marty!
I got a lot of things going on. If anyone's wondering about submitting fan art, there's sexually explicit instructions on my Tumblr, and links to my personal Tumblr where I typically answer questions. I've decided to have a Q&A the first Sunday of every month, subject to change. Remember, you do not need a Tumblr account to submit a question. I'll be there Sunday. Please remember to rate and subscribe to me if you're a conformist.
Hi, and welcome back to Pan Rants. And when I was a kid, I watched 90s cartoons. My childhood was awesome. Kids today ain't got nothing.
Oh, good for you. You watched a bunch of cartoons as a kid. What have you done as an adult? Oh, I remember being obsessed with everything 90s and hated everything else. So young, stupid, signed petitions, wanted to take the channel back, watched Bill O'Reilly unironically, couldn't tell the difference between a crocodile and an alligator. There's just some things you all got to learn about high personal standards for children's cartoons.
They should cancel everything and play all the old shows on loop.
Hey, yeah, that'll be cool for about a month until you're watching the same episodes over and over, get tired and change the channel. Reasons why I don't watch Boomerang anymore.
Well, they should have never canceled these shows.
Unless your cartoon was short-lived and had more story potential, it's better off the show ended.
I hate the new SpongeBob, Pokemon, and Simpsons. Why won't they end?
Well, shit, do you want the show to end when it's good or go on until you're complaining the old episodes were better? There's only so much mileage you can milk from these concepts. Creators often admit they tire of the show and want to try something new, including Samurai Jack.
TV stations don't treat shows with respect anymore, canceling everything.
Where were you when Sonic Satayam, MTV Downtown, Pirates of Dark Water, Freakazoid were constantly moved around the schedule, aired out of order, or just never finished their story? Must I remind you when the SWAT Cats ended for being too violent? Or when Kids WB and Fox Kids were edging out Western animation in exchange for animes?
TV is so unoriginal now.
Kinda like all the Scooby-Doo knockoffs in the 70s, Power Ranger or Pokemon knockoffs in the 90s, Ninja Turtle knockoffs in the 80s. Transformers were ripped off by the GoBots, which technically was sold first, and then the Rock Lords. They were robots that turned into rocks. Fucking rocks.
Flash animation is lazy.
Oh, hang on, let me just download Flash and press the Make a Cartoon button. It's very easy, it doesn't matter how skilled you are. Flash always looks like crap since there's no effort put into anything. It's not at all a real art form.
But cartoons now are just so weird.
Yeah, cause Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles made so much fucking sense. Look, Rambo the cartoon, Ren and Stimpy, Cow and Chicken, that's real intelligent humor. A grown man making little girls out of condiments and ecstasy. Some rich jackoff dressing like a bat beating up clowns and scarecrows with his underwear on the outside. Is this a superhero comic or Liberace's Wizard of Oz?
This picture I found.
What the shit does this have to do with Vietnam? This was from a clip used only once before the Powerpuff Girls movie and features Hanna-Barbera characters pre-Cartoon Network. The bottom was for bumpers in between commercials. When the channel plays movies, you expect them to animate a character for each seat multiple times? Cartoon Network still airs these shows, either on Boomerang or the Cartoon Planet block. Can't say the same for other channels on retro appreciation, except for the Hub Channel or Teen Nick, you know, if you actually have that channel. But I guess we'll never be able to watch all our favorite old shows again instantly and for free anywhere.
Cartoons today can't get away with anything.
While there's still plenty of friendly shows like Gravity Falls or My Little Pony, we get away with much worse nowadays. The Legend of Korra, Star Wars Clone Wars, Symbionic Titan got away with suicides, people getting stabbed or shot through the chest on screen. Rewatch a 90s action show and notice how many times they avoid showing a punch to the face without a flash or cutting away.
You're too old to be watching cartoons, you suck dick.
I'm sorry, I'm such a terrible person for watching a TV show, and I will not suck dick unless you pay me. Some of us do have standards.
Dick.
I don't think judging anything on a person by the TV show they watch is a very accurate representation, but maybe that's a topic for a whole nother video.
What video editing software do you use?
Sony Vegas.
Can you review edit a Netty?
Soon.
Do you have Asperger's?
With a side of fries.
Live action on Cartoon Network.
Oh, in 2009 I would have agreed with you. Now, all that's left is Incredible Crew. Level Up and everything else is cancelled. I just want you to keep this in mind. Not every show airing you're gonna like, and a lot of stuff you watched back then won't be as good as you remember it because you were 9 years old and thought Mike Lewinog was good. It's not. Some channels will get better or worse, and a lot of good shows will end too soon. Might as well enjoy it while it's around. The kids now will grow up to complain their shows were better than the ones in the future. You know this to be true. But there's one thing I want you all to do for me. Two amazing action cartoons, Young Justice and Green Lantern, have been canceled. They were part of Cartoon Network's Saturday morning DC Nation block. I think these shows would have done better on a Wednesday or Thursday night, not when I'm out of the house or sleeping in on a Saturday or Friday. Hashtag primetime DC Nation at Cartoon Network. Let it be known you'd watch these shows at a more convenient time. Don't let more action cartoons fade away like this. Hey, you kids want to see something fucked up? Often enough, animation is dead set on freaking children out because animators are douchebags. Submitted for the approval of the Midnight Society, these are four disturbing cartoon and television moments, Volume 1. A new compilation series I'm doing.
Creepy stuff happens in nowhere. It's up to Courage to save his new home.
Tonight we cover mainstream television only. Recent stuff a TV executive thought, hey, that's okay for kids, stick it in my ass, I don't care. Get ready to question your heterosexuality. It's Jews and Jam time. So there's this new 4-episode mini-series entitled Pokemon Origins that stayed true to the 151 Pokemon games, and it is hardcore. Guys, I don't want to become a Pokemon trainer anymore. This is actually Pokemon creator Satoshi's original vision, a realistic Pokemon world. Same goes for the long-running manga series. To be honest, when I was younger, I thought this was a coloring book.
Relax, Robin. I promise you won't feel a thing.
Not often is there a psychological thriller in a cartoon. The Teen Titans episode Haunted was just unpleasant. Slade has risen from the dead, but no one except Robin is able to see him.
What happened?
You are hurting me.
He was right there, you Princess Bubble bitch! The scary part is, we still don't know who Slade is, but I know who he is. He's Batman.
Slade is not Batman. He's Deathstroke the
it's
Terminator.
It's Batman!
My friends say you're not real.
I'm very real.
Batman! Man, I love being a turd hole. Hey, it's the 2003 Ninja Turtles that aired on the 4Kids animation block. These guys censored just about everything. How could anything slip by? Oh, damn. That's the thing. This episode, Insane in the Membrane, never even aired in America. 4Kids was like, yeah, we're not even gonna touch this episode. Just get it away from us.
They whittled me away, piece by piece.
A shame too, it was one of the more sympathetic episodes towards the villain, Baxter Stockman.
Why am I a failure? My whole life? Oh mama, I started with such promise.
P.
People, I'm not even joking. Do not even look. The next entry on the list is the toenail scene from SpongeBob. Last chance to look away. Okay, here we go. Oh, why? No,
okay,
no.
It's
on
my foot.
Oh, no. Okay, it's okay to look. No, it's not, it's not. Oh no, why? I got a sadistic sense of humor, but that was just unpleasant. I'll find more disturbing TV some other time. For now, I call this meeting of the Midnight Society closed. Bitches. Good news, Jews. I'm done with the stupid school, stupid semester. Kids, don't go to college. Run to California and make cartoons. Hopefully I now have more free time to worry about Teen Titans Go Ninja, Go Ninja, Go.
Go Ninja, Go Ninja, Go. Go Ninja, Go Ninja.
Go fuck yourself.
I believe I came into this show wanting to give it a fair chance. Okay, so someone said we want to cash in on the popularity of Teen Titans, but we don't want to spend too much money. So we made a low-budget Flash-animated cartoon called Teen Titans Go, which is also the title of a comic book based on the first animated series, simply called Teen Titans. It's insulting enough you ruined the name of Teen Titans. You gotta screw over the Google searches for the comic. Why you gotta be like this? I tried to hate it, but Teen Titans Go is pretty funny. Teen Titans Go fuck yourself? No. Teen Titans Go pat yourself on the back. They don't fight crime much in here. The Titans just slack off and abuse their powers to make clones or sandwiches, and that's where the humor comes from. It hurts to say this, but I recommend Teen Titans Go. Still, it's cool the main voice cast from the first series is back, but you got them back for this? It should have never been named Teen Titans. Let's just say someone big working on the show told me they'd much rather have an action show. Fans are disgruntled with the altered character personalities like Starfire valuing her hair more than Cyborg's arm, and I'm like, are those nitpicks in this parody really your only problem with this show? I'd be more mad this cartoon exists. Ugh, Osama bin Laden. I don't really like his beard. He'd be more charismatic if he shaved it. The most controversial change would be Raven enjoying My Little Pony in the show. She ruined Teen Titans, bloggers proclaimed. Say what you want about Injustice, Raven, but how dare you all say such things about my chibi waifu? By Thor's balls, it's a comedy. She may not have curves or an animation budget, but she's still beautiful to me, damn it. I still love her. I want Brony Raven to have my abortion and eat the baby as soup.
I still love you. No!
The animation looks nice standing still. In motion, it's a very mediocre grade of Flash. Colors feel as if they were melted down a box of highlighters and Mission Hill DVDs. Looks meh, but the humor makes up for it. I guess it's a good thing this is a comedy, since there's currently an oversaturation of action shows like... Ninja Turtles, that reboot is great. I wish I had the time to review it. If you love the balance of humor and seriousness reminiscent of the old Teen Titans cartoon, you should check in on that reboot. Teen Titans Go is kind of a detriment when action shows are a dying breed. If it's successful, it's gonna discourage the production of action cartoons. This is why it must be destroyed. At all cost. I'm sorry. I likes ya. I wants ya. I wants the booty. But this should have never been about the Teen Titans. It's like if someone were to create a show called America's Funniest Snuff Films. Hilarious. Yes, definitely. But it's for the greater good that you just go fuck yourself. Or this could show there's still an interest in Teen Titans. As I complained in the other Teen Titans review, if you don't like a superhero show, wait a few years for the next reboot. I like this show, but I don't want it to be successful. With that review out of the way, remember that gamer channel I made and never used? Well, I turned it into a Let's Play channel, RT Mega Drive. Right now playing through some too spooky RPG called Mad Father after my real life friend forced me to. I'll be sure to play between that and a cartoon related video and or Flash games. Let's Plays are ultra quick to make in under a day, so it should have zero effect on my already messed up review schedule of whenever the fuck I want.
Hey, yeah, I just like to recommend you play Snow.
Also, that Loki IRL webcomic I'm doing, it's almost here, and if it sucks, please someone reboot it. I must prepare my portfolio for San Diego Comic-Con, and a review of Code Lyoko you all demanded. Pie Guy rules,
out. Cartoon Network released 6 TV pilots online. 2 of them are announced to become a full series. The rest are in limbo as a single episode test run.
Can I see that?
I'm linking the episodes in the description, along with a grocery list and all my favorite vowels. If you live in a country that blocks you from watching these pilots, good luck with that. If they blocked Canada, then sorry, you don't deserve good cartoons or free healthcare. I'm here to make like genitalia and expose these cartoons to all my underage viewers. So here is my personal top 6 Cartoon Network pilots. It's juice and jam time.
Excuse me, I don't agree 100% with your personal opinions.
Hey man, that's cool, I respect that.
Cause this is my United States or whatever. Live free or die.
Absolutely the most unappealing of the 6 shorts, Mars Safari follows characters I refuse to believe were designed by a mentally functional human being exploring Mars.
You have mental problems, kid.
Yeah, I do.
An hour after my viewing, I forgot half of what happened in the episode. Worth some laughs, but I would never watch this again.
Danger Loves Company.
I created a totally awesome robot with incredible time travel hair, who sometimes gets on my nerves.
Get off my nerves, get off my nerves!
Now. Right off the back, I assume my science fiction project had some relation to Sheep in the Big City. It did not, although it shares a resemblance to another series. Do you like Secret Mountain Fort Awesome?
Yes.
No, you did not. I'm the only person in the world who watched that show. My science fiction project is that kind of humor. Nasty and weird. It's a meh of a show, but there's no appeal for this kind of gross-out show anymore. If Cow and Chicken came out today, it would have never worked.
We shall rule the universe as father and puppies!
Oh, hello! Are you a potato?
Harvey! What now?
At number 4 is Paranormal Roommates. 2 slacker mythical creatures are caretaken by a government agent. It's nothing more than regular show with a bit of ugly Americans thrown in, if Mordecai and Rigby had severe dependency issues.
It cuts these wee atoms.
Regular show storyboard artist Benton Connor created this, and it has no purpose on this earth. Why attempt to make a knockoff of a cartoon you're currently working on? As it turns out, this is a watered-down remake of a college short film Benton Connor created in college. Give that one a watch instead. It's actually its own thing.
No fighting, remember?
If you're evil and you're on the rise, you can count on the 4 of us taking you down.
Let me tell you about Rebecca Sugar. She storyboarded some of the best stories on Adventure Time, composed most of the songs you love on there, and draws Ed, Ed, and Eddie Yowie. You may not think that last one's an accomplishment, but I do. Rebecca Sugar quit Adventure Time to create Steven Universe, already in full swing for a series about an adventurous kid hanging around older girls who either mess with or are condescending towards him. Together, they use wacky magical powers to fight evil.
Is this normal? Are we winning?
No, this is bad, Steven. Help!
I can't! I'm a buttface.
The verdict? It's Adventure Time with no dog and more princess. I freaking love the designs, the colors, the varied body types, the fact that it's the only cartoon on the list that isn't a sausage fest. But what irks me is a major factor of Adventure Time quit Adventure Time to make a show the near exact same as Adventure Time. You may defend Paranormal and Steven for being rehashes because the same crew are working on it, yet Dexter's Lab, Powerpuff, Samurai Jack, and Foster's had primarily the same crew, and each one of those were so distinct from one another. Since the college short of Paranormal Roommates is so different from the current pilot, I think what happened was these two shows were gonna be something else until Cartoon Network forced them to emulate what's popular. I'm too negative sometimes. One episode is not enough to judge. I do like it so far. It's just that I hope it'll grow into its own style.
Don't make fun of Steven.
Yeah. This clown is gonna save your lives.
And then at midnight, we get to bust open my Missy Lee pinata.
I can't pick a favorite. The final 2 cartoons on my list are a tie. 1 minute into Clarence, I'm already glad this has been greenlit for a full series. Stupid, but funny. 2 minutes in, I feel sympathetic towards him for inviting classmates over when hardly anyone wants anything to do with him.
Boo!
Oh, that used to be me. It's weird, but it has a relatable charm of what you used to do when you invite friends over. Maybe I'm looking too much into this, but I'm expecting this to be one of those funny cartoons with some sentimental moments. Another Adventure Time rehash? Not quite. It's not a rehash. It takes inspiration from that, plus Dragon Ball, plus Street Fighter, and all the 80s culture you get at a regular show in Gravity Falls.
Find the graffiti wiener.
Radicles? A wiener is you!
What we got here is a hyperactive kid who talks like young Goku in a shopping plaza of all these creative superheroes challenging people to Street Fighter-style battles. If you're gonna take ideas from so many sources, go big or go homo. And this show goes homo. It's only a one-episode pilot, but damn if I want this to be a series and a video game. If you're gonna ask yourself one thing in your life, ask yourself this. Do you want Adventure Time meets Tenchi Muyo? Or do you want Adventure Time meets the 1980s and Dragon Ball? Holy balls. I just made a video in under 2 weeks. I must be having consensual sex with a woman, because that's impossible. A lot of you have been asking me to review GarageBand. Who cares? It's Canadian. Canadians aren't even human as far as we know. I'm unsure if I'll review it or if it's any good. How about Nickelodeon's newest show, Some Gays and Craig? It's fairly standard bromance stuff you see nowadays on cartoons. A boy and his pet being idiots trying to impress older girls. To me, it feels a bit like Finn and Jake's personality from Adventure Time in the world of regular show. You say the show is juvenile? Oh yeah. From how fast-paced and over-the-top they take it, I actually like the humor. But maybe it's gonna be too gross for some people. The first episode is about butt replacement surgery. I think Adventure Time created the resurgence of humor based around the word butt. This could be it. This could be the year of the butt. Let me not forget the intro song. How long has it been since there was a catchy opening for a cartoon? Can I show a clip of the intro song without getting in trouble with Nickelodeon's parent company Viacom? No. Thurup Van Orman, who gave you Flapjack, is a supervising producer on this show. He clearly had a lot to do with the humor. I must say, Flapjack is one of the best looking animated shows I've ever watched. Sanjay and Craig's art style is about as basic as Basic Instinct 2. I find it hard to believe it took three people to come up with the idea for this show, one of them so blatantly being the character designer for Bob's Burgers. Yeah, Bob's Burgers, great show, but saying you're the character designer is like saying you programmed overly long turret levels in every video game ever. It's nothing to be proud of. I'm so sorry, I just absolutely hate never-ending turret levels. My doctor says I have a lot of turret levels. Look at that smug son of a bitch, Sanjay. That plain white t-shirt, that chin of an eagle raptor. He has less chins than a Chinese phone book made before the phone was invented. I wouldn't fuck this guy with a 10-foot pole. I don't want to fuck guys in general, but given the option, it wouldn't be this guy. The more I think about it while working on this video is I can't tell if I don't like the designs or not. It hits like a middle ground with me. The simplicity of Sanjay and Craig does help them push the facial expressions. Yeah, art style... Well, at least you're not Seth MacFarlane. Comedy? If you like Flapjack and regular show, oh yeah, you'll love this. I think Nickelodeon is doing a good job at getting better shows. Too bad their two other good shows are on hiatus till next season. I can only pray Nickelodeon will get more than one good show running at the same time, without relying on endless SpongeBob episodes. Fairly Odd Parents is still running? What the hell? Comic-Con will be coming up mid-July, so subscribe to my Archive Taxi channel, where I will upload panel footage of whatever panel I can make it to, mostly cartoon stuff. There's a lot of junk in there from last year, too. I got a portfolio to work on again. This time I actually know what I'm doing. I will be another step closer to fulfilling my dream of getting a cartoon. My other dream is to lose my virginity while marathoning my own videos. This Comic-Con, I'll face Tara Strong again, and this time, we'll see who eats whose spaghetti. I am the ultimate life form. Hello, Internet, and welcome to Gay Theory. Tonight we'll be discussing Steven Universal Healthcare. Cartoon Network's next great harem anime is here. Move over, Powerpuff Girls.
That's not a harem anime.
When they're 18 years old, it's gonna be a harem. Steven Universe is a comedy of three mystical women labeled as gems, protecting both the real world and a magical domain, while this young boy Steven tags along to screw everything up. The comedy's good, but what really grabbed me was when they bring up Steven and his father's relationship, and the message of the show about human flaws. Even when Steven screws up, everyone's fine with it. The show embraces imperfection, whether it be the varied body types or the off-model expressions. Distracting at first, it gives the show personality.
You're not perfect, Steven, but you're still a goddamn idiot.
If every pork chop were perfect,
we wouldn't have hot dogs!
That's not how hot dogs are made! That's like if I microwave ramen noodles for too long, I end up with mac and cheese. Because the creator of the show is Rebecca Sugar, there's extra effort put into the music. She wrote much of the songs for Adventure Time, and many of the sympathetic episodes pertaining to Marceline's relation to the Ice King and her father. Rebecca Sugar is capable of doing three things: writing music, stories with daddy issues, and drawing this face. Also, she can do Hyper Beam, but it takes like 5 hours for it to work. I'll link you to one of the music artists of the series in the description. Avi and Sarushu. Her music score really makes me want to play Mario Galaxy again. As for the visuals, there's a whole controversy over the first test pilot episode sporting a different art style. The two styles are so different, I'd be okay with either or, but I prefer the new one. Now, they're more uniquely structured, the colors and backgrounds are dreamlike, and I missed thick outlines in cartoons. Sometimes more detail doesn't mean it's better. Unless you're the new Batman Adventures, that was a big mistake. The setting is also worth noting. I'm very interested in wanting to know more about this mystical domain Steven's not allowed into. Is it alive? What could be hidden inside? Maybe it's the suitcase from Pulp Fiction, or Al Capone's wallet. Perhaps the key to Aaron Yeager's basement. What if it's an embarrassing photo of Steven at the Christmas party, or a nice stash of Mary Jane? I'm so sorry I doubted this show. I can't even pick a favorite gem, Garnet. But one thing is still bugging me. The gems are combat experienced superhumans, yet Steven, who's still in training, ends up saving them every time, or makes things worse. I guess the message of the show is that women are incompetent and Steven, despite all his faults and his inexperience, is a superior person as a white man. Looks like Rebecca Sugar is some sort of massage anus. Before I sign off, I was a YouTube partner with the Game Over Network, which I'll link to you in the description. Now I am currently a YouTube partner with Frederator. They emailed me praising my work, including that Bravest Warriors review I did, where I said it was a complete knockoff and the people who made it suffer some sort of condition. Anyway, I am incredibly thankful they want me to be associated with them. Sometimes I lose sleep over the bad stuff I've said in these videos about people and companies I admire.
Why don't you pitch a show to Frederator?
They don't do raunchy comedy action shows, and little by little, my webcomic I'm working on is getting closer to completion. If I'm gonna animate anything, I'm gonna try it myself first. And another bit of news, Billy and Mandy's creator Maxwell Adams and his Kickstarter for Dead Meat is funded.
Thanks to Pan Pizza / Rebel Taxi for the interview and reblogging to his massive number of followers. And
that means I gotta do the Ed and Eddie review like I promised in my interview with him. Eventually, I'll do it. I got some videos planned first.
Here at the school, and I need your help. Listen, it's a real emergency. I'm stuck in a closet with tons of mud, so get here fast. Help me!
Once upon a time, a TV network gave us an after-school action block of Japanese anime, until that was replaced with a block of anime from France. This inferior action block known as Magoozy gave us a mixed bag of shows like Totally Spies, where I speculate we all watched for one reason. The most requested show for me to talk about is Code Lyoko. On the surface, Code Lyoko is more formulaic than Disney's Penis and Perv, and its sextacular movie, Penis and Perv Get a Second Erection. An evil computer program called Xanet causes disaster, so the group of two-dimensional middle schoolers enter a 3D virtual world called Lyoko to disable his attacks. Very slowly. Once Xanet's attacks are halted, the brains of the Operation Jeremy sends everyone back in time to undo the damage Xanet caused. Yeah, Jeremy's gonna take you back to the past, to when his father touched him in the ass. That's every episode over and over. Besides the touching ass part, that never happens. So you ask, where's the sense of danger if they're in a virtual world and they can just reverse time? Problem is, they die and go back in time, they're still dead, and the guys in the virtual world aren't in peril. Everyone else is. You know, as a kid, you always pictured yourself being part of the main characters in a cartoon. How about picturing yourself in this cartoon? Seems like fun, right? What's the worst they could deal with? Aw, hell no. On second thought, I'm joining the kids next door. Screw you guys. Xan is able to possess humans, handle nuclear weapons, create natural disasters, and oh god, the bees.
Help! Get him off! Ah!
Fuck you, Clarence! Fuck you, fat piece of shit! In retrospect, this was too brutal to have been a kid's show. They got away with so much. If you're into underage girls with giant foreheads, be my guest. The censors did not care. This show's darker than the neighborhoods I never drive through. They could shut off the super computer harboring Xana, but that would kill off this virtual girl named Aelita, trapped in Lyoko. So the real world kids have to escort her safely to temporarily disable Xana, while eventually trying to find a way to get her out, which they do by season 1.
She's here at last. Welcome to Earth.
That was a good performance, but I prefer the Will Smith version.
Welcome to Earth.
Aelita is, after all, Jeremy's fictional girlfriend, or waifu.
Hey guys, guess what I did last night?
No one wants to know, pervert. Instead of protecting Aelita himself, Jeremy sends his friends to save her. He's basically Lord Fuckwad from Shrek, sending other chums to save his princess. This goes against every Shrek movie I believe in. What happened to swag? Shrek was a great movie. In the virtual world of Lyoko, the kids are given powers, but the comic relief of the group, Odd, was the lamest.
Oh, I get the idea, Geronimo!
First off, his name is Odd. Second, his pet ice cream cone looks like Frankenweenie. That can be really good or really bad depending on your opinion on that film. Third, he becomes this kinky purple-yellow cat thing. Either that's a horrible color scheme or he's a fan of the Lakers. Lastly, his weapons were arrows, and if he ran out, good luck.
No, Hawkeye, wait, you're leaving?
Well, yeah, I mean, I need my arrows. It's kind of my thing, right? You guys got this.
To repeat myself, Code Lyoko is formulaic. You'll see them in the same four locations, fight the same monsters like the angry potatoes. You'd expect them to run out of ideas for how Xana can strike.
Okay, who just downloaded 40 gigabytes of panda furry porn?
Xana, he must be behind this.
Odd, I fucking swear to God right now.
In Execution, they try their best to change things up by Season 2. More monsters, a new member, secrets revealed on Lyoko, and because the Lyoko kids are the only ones who remember anything after returning to the past, most character advancement they've made with the side characters, who they usually bicker with, is lost. It's funny to see them become nicer towards the side characters who don't remember their experiences together, and in turn, they start getting along. It really makes them more likable, they don't hold a grudge.
Project Carthage was a military program used to block enemy communications.
For now, it seems that the authorities can't quote a figure on the number of people who have actually been stricken by the illness.
We've been swamped with calls warning us of a mysterious epidemic.
So I built a supercomputer, created Lyoko, and last of all, Xana, to destroy Carthage.
He has the keys to Lyoko. He'll be able to get out of the supercomputer.
No!
Give me all you got! Go on! Huh? Is that all you got?
Code Lyoko started as this strange little pilot entitled Garage Kids. Oh, silly me, that's MTV's The Head. When you look back on it now, Garage Kids and Code Lyoko itself may feel clunky, the editing can get awkward, but you see the ambition they had for this series. Kids could handle some pretty brutal stories.
It's been so great, I just don't want it to end.
There'll be plenty of other good times, even without Lyoko.
Promise?
Cut to the present where a massively multiplayer online game is in the works, and a live-action to CGI TV series is going on in France, Code Lyoko Evolution. Oh wait, that's the Coneheads. I've yet to watch it. You may hate the live-action change, but a repetitive series like Lyoko, I'd welcome it. And the series itself taught me that maybe someday we'll be able to bring all our cartoon waifus into the real world. You will be mine, Miss Nisox.
You're a hero, and a fantastic P.E. teacher, Jimbo.
Oh, well, you ought to tell the principal that. Okay, now, go to class. Hero.
Quick, jump on!
Magoobies making waves on Cartoon Network.
Tell me about it.
Dive in. Totally Spies at
5. Hello, ladies.
Code Lyoko at 5:30.
Anita, help is on the way.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles at 6. Come up for air with Teen Titans at 6:30.
Hope you came looking for a fight, because you definitely found it.
Magoozy, weekdays 5 to 7. Come on in, the water's fine.
That's what I call getting carried away.